Good morning and welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Education and Culture Committee in 2015. Can I remind all those present that electronic devices should be switched off at all times. They do interfere with the sound system. This morning our first item of business is to hear from the Scottish Government on funding of this year's Tea in the Park Festival. And can I welcome to the committee Fiona Hyslop, the Cabinet Secretary for Culture, Europe and External Affairs, and her accompanying officials. Good morning to all of you. And can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some opening remarks? Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Hold on a second, Cabinet Secretary.
Secretary starts. At the pre-meeting, you did say that you would hope that 45 minutes had been allocated for this evidence session. I don't believe that 45 minutes is enough with the circumstances surrounding us. And I would ask that this be extended to at least as long as it takes.
Right, the Cabinet Secretary, our intent, that was a discussion that took place in private. As was said before in this committee, discussing matters which are in the public domain, which are discussed in private by the committee, is not an acceptable way to behave, John. You should know that by now. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, committee and convener. I'm pleased to have the opportunity this morning to speak to the committee about the Scottish Government's support for Tea in the Park Festival. On the 14th of August, I provided a detailed account to Parliament on my decision to provide funding support for this festival in responding to a parliamentary question lodged by Liz Smith. Members of the committee should have the text of that answer, along with a detailed timeline of the decision-making process, indicating that we published information on the grant on the 28th of July, almost immediately after the payment of the grant. In offering some opening remarks, I'd like to highlight the motion that was passed by this Parliament in April that recognised the key role that our festivals and cultural events play in making Scotland a great place to live, work, study and visit, and enhancing our international reputation. Indeed, cross-party members spoke of the economic benefit of Tea in the Park in particular. The Tea in the Park Festival plays just such a key role. It is one of the most popular and successful cultural events in Scotland's annual events programme. Since it was first staged in 1994, Tea in the Park has become a rite of passage for many of our young people, and each year it delivers significant economic impact, drives additional tourism and supports jobs, and last year it generated £15.4 million for the Scottish economy. I first became aware that Tea in the Park's organisers were expressing concerns over the longer-term viability of the event in May, and as Cabinet Secretary with lead responsibility on major events, I met with the CEO of DF Concerts and Events to discuss this serious situation. It was clear to me that the organisers faced a number of unanticipated additional costs in staging the event as a result of the requirement to move from the previous site at Balado and the three-year-only time-limited condition attached to the planning consent for use of the new site at Strathallan. And following a detailed consideration of options, I approved funding of £150,000 from my major events budget for operational costs associated with the transition to the new site, subject to a number of conditions, including the successful delivery of this year's event and with a clawback clause should the event not be delivered in 2016 or 2017. This was done in order to seek to protect the future of an important and iconic event and its cultural, economic and reputational benefits for Scotland. And I'm happy to answer any questions that committee members may have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. We'll go straight to questions and we'll kick off with Mary Scanlon.
My first question is actually something of a complaint. As a member of the Audit Committee, I know how important the audit trail is. When our committee papers came out on Thursday, I asked the clerk, Terry, for the audit trail. All you gave us was a written answer to Liz Smith and a list of meetings and dates. That is not an audit trail. The clerk to this committee spoke to government officials on Thursday night, and he was told, and I have an email, there is nothing else is available. In other words, there's no audit trail. You've got what there is. Last night, I got home around 8 o'clock after my Pilates class, and I find 628 pages of an audit trail. Do you consider that courteous to this committee? Because I actually consider it's contemptuous. Mind you, it wasn't that difficult to read. A lot of it looked like that. But 628 pages came in less than 16 hours in advance of this meeting, and those 628 pages were not available on Thursday evening. Can I have a response, please?
The committee asked for information. The information was supplied to the committee. The information that was issued last night was as a result of a number of Freedom of Information requests. As the member will know, in relation to Freedom of Information legislation, information that is of commercial confidential matters would be redacted, and indeed also issues around security. The vast majority of the Freedom of Information was actually about the transport issues, and as far as I'm aware, this committee is not actually looking at the transport issues in relation to the information. They want to know what was paid out and why, and indeed when the information was provided in relation to the parliamentary question I answered on the 14th of August. I would also point out that in terms of the question that I answered fully on the 14th of August, Liz Smith asked specifically, all she asked was how much money and what dates. I took an early opportunity to make sure the answer that I gave was much, much fuller than that, because I wanted to provide information. I did provide information, and that answer was indeed published earlier than the final date that was required. In terms of the dates of decision making, you have the information there, but in terms of the budget information that was supplied to us in relation to what were the additional and extra costs that were being met by T in the Park in relation to the transition, that was provided to us, but that's commercial sensitive information and has not been supplied either to the committee or indeed for the Freedom of Information. I thought it was courteous to the committee that should the information be given to those that had provided for Freedom of Information requests, that that information could be provided. The vast majority of that is about transport issues, which, you know, that's a separate matter, I think, than the inquiry that the committee is looking to proceed.
Information was there. Mm-hmm. The fact that you chose to give that information to whoever requested it, journalist or whoever, and they have every right to do that, you refused that information to me on Thursday night. Are you saying that a freedom of information and a journalist's request for that takes precedence over a parliamentary committee? And had it not been for a freedom of information request, we would not have had our 628 pages today. We would only have had your timeline.
Well, the timeline takes you through what decisions were
made. Doesn't give an audit trail.
It gives you the information of what was requested when. It gives you...
Well, doesn't give an audit trail.
Well... It provides you a systematic distillation of what happened when and what monies were released when, what decisions were taken when. To me, that gives you, in terms of my provision to the committee, I wanted to make sure you had clarity of what happened when, and that's exactly what was provided to the committee. We could have given you a whole range of transport information that you would have then or your clerks would have had to work the way through. I thought it was much more beneficial to the committee to have everything laid out in a systematic way, driven by date. That is the trail of the dates and the decisions that were taken. That, in addition to the parliamentary answer that I provided on the 14th of August, gives the comprehensive situation of what happened and when.
I'd like to reserve the right to ask the Cabinet Secretary back, given that these answers so far are unsatisfactory. I move on to my questions, Convener. Why were DF concerts and tenants, the main sponsor, why were they so desperate for taxpayers' money when DF Concerts have had a profit of over 5 million, 4.75 million and 4.5 million in the last 3 years? Could they not afford the £150,000? And can I just say, the holding company, with a 78% share in DF Concerts, have a turnover of £167 million. So why did they come here for £150,000?
Well, two things. The committee will be aware that the Scottish Government provides funding for profitable companies to safeguard jobs and support the economy in all of the sectors that they're part of the key of the economic strategy of the government. There are seven sectors. Creative industries and tourism are two of the seven sectors. So that would not be an unusual situation. However, in relation to Tea in the Park, the costs of the transition and particularly the unanticipated costs meant that any of the, in terms of, they themselves have given information that a seven-figure amount was required to provide for those costs, in particular moving from Balado to Strathallan. In light of the seven-figure costs in relation to the cost aspect and also in relation to the reduced revenues, the severely reduced revenues that they were anticipating as provided to us in their budgeting in relation to that event, meant that the event itself for this year certainly, and possibly for years going forward, would not be in a position that they would want to continue, and that shareholders of the companies she is citing were giving them indication that it would be preferable for them to move, if there was not a profitability for this event itself, to move from the multi-day, multi-stage festival, which brings the economic benefit to rural Perthshire, and to move that to have single-day, single-stage events, possibly in other cities like Glasgow, as they have been doing recently, or indeed to move the festival itself away from Scotland. That would have the economic situation where the £15.4 million worth of economic benefit coming to Scotland would no longer be in Scotland. So the difference between the profitability and the interest of the company as regards to that event themselves, they can make the decision not to continue that event at Strathallan. That perhaps is why, as you might appreciate, the clawback clauses are there, particularly should the event not go ahead in 16 or 17, and indeed the grant was only given after the delivery of the event in 2015. So she's right to cite the profits of the company. That also means they will make decisions as to what event they will support or not support or continue with.
The letter briefing note from Jennifer Dempsey to the Cabinet Secretary on the 28th of May, her request is based on four main areas in budget regarding infrastructure: bridges, water supply investment, investment for copper and fibre, and trackway, a steel road. All of these are infrastructure. Now, if we go over to Jeff Ellis, and there's so many here, what we have from the Scottish Government Economic Development Directorate: under no circumstances can the grant be used to support infrastructure. Eligible operational are only venue hire and costs and the cost of consultants. Now, convener, I did read the 628 pages last night. Nowhere did I hear anything about the venue hire? Yep. Nothing about the cost of consultants. This request was for infrastructure, and given that our time is limited to 45 minutes, can I just put it to the Cabinet Secretary? This was a done deal, given the applicant's close connections with the SNP, the £150,000 to a company with multi-million pound profits. You decided to allocate the money. Then you scurried round the state aid, and there was more than £150,000 spent in officials' time to find which budget it might fit into. The request was for infrastructure, and under no circumstances could this money be paid for infrastructure. So if this is not a fraudulent application, I would like the Cabinet Secretary to tell us why.
I'm just going to urge caution about the use of that language. Just be careful.
Well, I'd be very happy if she told us that there was nothing fraudulent
Cabinet
here.
Convener, I'm sure you will take the guidance of this committee very carefully in terms of the language that is used and the allegations that are being made. The grant, the terms of the grant was published on the 28th of July. The actual grant application itself was also published. So you'll be able to actually identify that information. In relation to the applicant, Jeff Ellis has no, as far as I'm aware, associations with the SNP. It was Jeff Ellis I met with, Jeff Ellis that I had the discussion with. Jeff Ellis is the chief executive of DF Concerts. And in relation to the application itself and the terms and conditions, I was quite clear in my meeting with DF Concerts in May that I thought it would be a challenge to identify what could be done in terms of support because of other funding that the DF concerts had already received. So, for example, Glasgow City Council, for example, over the last period in 13-14, have provided £200,000, which is more, indeed. Well, it does, Convener, if I can continue with my point, in terms of the different areas of state aid that could be required, de minimis state aid was not applicable in this case because of the other public money that had gone into that particular company. So, therefore, de minimis would have meant that under £200,000, that wouldn't have been the case in the case of DF concerts because of the money that they received from Glasgow City Council. In terms of investment in infrastructure, that was not also applicable under state aid. What was able to be provided would be operational state aid for the transition, specifically for venue hire and specific for those costs that were particular to the transition, i.e. planning consultants' costs, and that was the operation of the grant that was provided. It was also the one that was applied for.
Liz Smith.
Cabinet Secretary, in paragraph 4.2 of the letter that the Scottish Government sent to Jeff Ellis in July 2015, we don't have the exact date, incidentally, all we have is July 2015, it says that the guarantee, namely DF Concerts, shall, on completion of the project, submit a report to the Scottish Ministers summarising the performance of that project. Such a report shall include the statistical and other information relating to the impact of the project, as shall be required by Scottish Ministers. It should also include a clear breakdown of what the grant was used for. Now, despite repeated attempts by many members of this Parliament, by journalists, by various other things, we do not actually have that clear business case on which this whole award was made. And last night, obviously, members of the committee received a half a document, much of which is redacted. Can you clarify exactly what the business case was for you providing this money of £150,000? Because as yet, we don't have that on record.
In order for the Scottish Government to provide a grant, particularly those in relation to state aid and in terms of the exemptions that we identified would allow it to be paid, for it to achieve accountable officer approval, which it did at senior civil service level, we had to be assured of a certain information, not least, yes, the company report accounts that were provided to us, but also commercially in confidence. That's why it's been redacted from Freedom of Information requests, and also in relation to the budget for the event itself, which again is commercially in confidence. I would point out that the planning approval for this year's Tea in the Park took place barely 8 weeks before the event was meant to take place. That also had an implication on ticket sales, which meant the revenue costs in terms of what would be achieved for that event would also be problematic. So in terms of the information that was required, it was provided to us, and in terms of the rationale, it was provided. The report about the statistical information relating to the impact and indeed the expenditure, it will be provided to the Scottish Government. It's required to be provided to the Scottish Government, and it will be provided. That's part of the conditions of the grant.
One other question was
back on that point. Obviously, Perth and Kinross are they're the ones that award the planning consent for this project. At what stage did you have discussions with Perth and Kinross about the viability of this project, given you cite that there are extreme circumstances? Did you discuss this with Perth and Kinross as well as DF Concerts?
I respect the independence of Perth and Kinross Council. They independently can take their planning decisions. They took their planning decisions. That was their responsibility. It would not have been a correct situation for the Scottish Government to try and interfere with the planning decisions that they took. Now, the decision they took to limit the planning conditions to 3 years rather than 5 years clearly had implications for the transitional costs, which could no longer be spread over a longer period of time, but had to be concentrated in a period of 3 years. And it was part of that decision-making process, which I did not interfere with, and neither should I have interfered with.
With respect, Cabinet Secretary, it's not about interfering. I totally accept that it's not for the Scottish Government to do that. May I just finish, Convener? It's about the adequate information. Given that you're citing that there were extreme circumstances, possibly relating to the viability of this whole festival, Was there any discussion between the Scottish Government, DF Concerts and Perth and Kinross Council about that?
I think DF Concerts speaks themselves for their discussions with Perth and Kinross Council. I personally did not have a discussion with Perth and Kinross Council.
Okay, thank you. Gordon,
I don't have discussions with other local authorities where we fund festivals, and indeed right across Scotland we provide funding for festivals all over, not least in this city, but also in other parts of the country, and we make decisions as the Scottish Government.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Gordon.
Thanks very much, Convener. I just want to clear something up before I go on to my own questions. Mary Scanlon asked you a number of points relating to Jennifer Dempsey, and I don't want to get any individual involved, but I just want to make the picture clear. Did you know that the request for an initial meeting came from Jennifer Dempsey?
I didn't know that the request for the meeting in May came from Jennifer Dempsey. Jennifer Dempsey didn't attend the meeting that we had with DF Concerts, and indeed I had no discussions about funding with Jennifer Dempsey.
Right, that's fine. That clears up the point I wanted to make. In terms of state aid, the Scottish Government has a state aid unit. What was its role in the provision of grant funding to DF accounts? DF Concerts, sorry.
Well, clearly, it was absolutely essential that I took advice from State Aid, and indeed, we have a colleague from the State Aid Unit with us today, Alan Coleman. And in relation to the steps that we took in terms of the decision-making, of course, we would have checked what was applicable, what wasn't applicable, and to make sure that our State Aid functions were properly carried out. That also included notifying the European Commission about the application and indeed the allocation of the grant, and that was reported to the European Commission State Aid at the appropriate time. That was done fully and transparently. It was also published on the Scottish Government website at the time. So I was quite clear that we're very conscious of what can and cannot be done in relation to state aid, and that's why, for example, we couldn't provide the de minimis state aid because Glasgow City Council had already provided funding to the company. In terms of other investment, wasn't applicable, but clearly in relation to the transition, the additional cost in relation to the venue hire, and also in relation to planning consultants, not least the environmental aspect of what was happening, there was clearly with additional costs that were required for that particular move.
Okay. And the information that's provided by the clerks, the timeline that was provided by the clerks, on the 18th of June, further advice from major event officials to the Cabinet Secretary on options for supporting the Tea in the Park event. On the 26th of June, major event officials obtain accountable officer approval of intended approach to provide funding. And on the 26th of June, further funding advice provided to the Cabinet Secretary by major events officials. Are you able to share any of that advice, and what was the role of the accountable officer?
Well, in terms of the timeline, it was provided by ourselves to the clerks, and then the clerks provided it to the committee. So this is the information that we've provided. And in terms of the information that was provided to me, there was advice given to me by officials. Some of that is confidential because it has the information that we got from the company in relation to reports, accounts, and also in terms of the budgets for the event itself. But clearly this was not made in isolation by me, as being alleged by other members of this committee. It was made together and collectively with the advice of government officials, and indeed in terms of the signing off of the final grant, the role of the accountable officer at senior civil service level was appropriate, because that's what we do in situations of this kind. But I would point out that it is not unusual for government to support a company to safeguard jobs and keep and sustain the economic interests of this company, of this country. And I think there is a kind of, in sustaining the economic interests of this country, I think we have to reflect on the importance of this event. Creative industries and tourism and festivals are not second class in relation to the importance and impact on this economy. But clearly, that perhaps maybe the view of those that are not supportive of the festival, and indeed people that have spoken out against having the festival at all at this site. And there are obviously lots of interests at play. My interest is the economic interest of this country, and also for the cultural offering that we have to generations of young people, and the and indeed the development of the contemporary music scene in Scotland.
Thank you, Gamsek. Give me one quick supplementary.
You mentioned earlier about the European Commission. What was the significance of the European Commission issuing an official scheme number. What was the significance of that?
Well, that was a validation of the notification that was appropriate in terms of the fact that there not only was this state aid, but we also indicated where we thought the general exemption was in relation to this particular aspect. That means that, one, it's public. We make sure that people know about it. It also provides that the Commission can question it at any time, and that's part of the process of being open and transparent mm-hmm. about what we're doing.
Okay, thanks very much.
Mark, do you want a quick supplementary on this one?
Yep, it was a supplement. Just to clarify on an answer that you'd given, you'd said that the advice that you'd given was that the festival was under threat and may or may not go ahead. Is that correct?
Yes, and I would also refer you to the answer I gave on the 14th of August, paragraph 8. I said in that answer at that time, which was several months ago, that DF Concerts and Events had confirmed that the 2015 event could be delivered under pressure, but that the additional costs faced in relation to it were a threat to the longer-term viability on that site. And paragraph 11, when we made it quite clear that the grant was given in order to protect the future staging of the event in Scotland. So I've been clear about that right from the 14th of August. I'm not sure that's something that's perhaps been reported as widely as it might have been.
Okay, so just to be clear, it seemed to be from your previous answer that the 2015 festival was under threat if this funding wasn't awarded. Just to be clear then that that's not the case, that the 2015 festival was delivered regardless of any government funding.
Well, that's why the grant was given after the event, because it was only ever going to be given if the event took place. Now, the event did take place, but in terms of the longer-term viability, it was absolutely essential that we made sure that the clawback clauses were there for 16 and 17. At the time that I met DF Concerts in May, and that was only, I think, 16 days or so after the planning decision, which had limited it to 3 years as opposed to longer, and that obviously meant the spread of their costs, in particular the seven-figure costs that they were citing themselves, and that put additional pressure at that time. Now, even at that time, they weren't sure about whether it would be able to go ahead or not, but obviously in discussions and as it developed, it was clear that they could under pressure. But the point is, it's about the profitability of the event going forward, and if it is such that the company the shareholders that NDF Concerts think that this is not an event that they think provides them with what they need, then they will move. And I don't think it would be in the interests of Scotland. I'm quite clear. I'm standing up for Tea in the Park. I'm standing up for all the tens of thousands of people who go every year and the generations that have gone. And importantly, it's been a very important part of developing the music scene and indeed many of the contemporary music acts that have gone to greater and wider success in Scotland. I think that is in the interests of this country.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. George Adam.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Gordon MacDonald asked about Jennifer Dempsey, and there's been many allegations made regarding Ms Dempsey and her role in this. Can you just categorically tell us one way, what was her role in this whole scenario, and also, was she paid any consultancy fees from the grant itself?
The relationship with Jennifer Dempsey is clearly one between DF Concerts and Jennifer Dempsey as an employee. She was a staff member of DF Concerts. If she worked in terms of looking at arranging diaries for Jeff Ellis, that is a matter for DF Concerts in terms of her connections. In terms of her connections with me, I know of her for having worked as a special advisor, finishing a contract, I think, in 2009. So in relation to the last 6 years, I've not had a relationship with her either in terms of friendship or anything like that. My relationship clearly was with Jeff Ellis. She wasn't at the meeting. She didn't discuss any funding with me. And in terms of her relationship, she was a paid employee of DF Concerts. She wasn't a consultant. So in relation to some of the payment issues, for example, in relation to the grant itself for venue hire and planning consultants, that would not have gone to Jen Dempsey, because Jen Dempsey was an employee of DF Concerts. And planning consultants clearly are defined by the role in relation to the planning area. So that helps in trying to clear up some of the kind of allegations that are being made.
At the time, Cabinet Secretary, were you aware that Jennifer Dempsey was actually trying to make the appointments, or were you not involved at that stage?
I wasn't involved. I mean, I don't see every piece of correspondence that comes in. And, actually, because Jen Dempsey stopped being a special advisor probably about, that's, I know, 6-7 years ago, there's no reason why MD in my office would know who she was. So she wasn't, part of the meeting. She didn't discuss funding with me. My meeting was with Jeff Ellis. If Jeff Ellis, who's the chief executive of the biggest festival in Scotland, wants to meet you because he has concerns about the viability of that event, I think you meet him.
Okay, thank you.
Cabinet Secretary, why then would a private company be able to secure direct access to the Cabinet Secretary through Ms. Dempsey, a former aide to Alex Salmond, rather than through the official channel?
Excuse me, would you mind moving your mic closer? I'm sorry, I'm having difficulty picking you up. Thank you. Would you want, sorry, I didn't catch the beginning of your...
Yeah, just following on from George Adam there. Could you perhaps then tell us why a private company is able to secure access to your office through Ms. Dempsey, a former aide to Alex Salmond, you know, rather than through the official channels?
Well, the answer is the official channels are DF Concerts, as a company gets in touch with me. I didn't know who the individual was that was making the arrangements for that. So therefore, I think that kind of answers your point that one, the request was from the biggest company, the biggest events company I think we have in Scotland, that are, and the chief executive of the biggest events company that runs the biggest music festival wanted to meet with me, and I thought that was a reasonable thing to do. Government meet with business people all the time. We meet with festivals. I meet with festival directors across Scotland all the time. That is a normal thing to do in government, and particularly if there are issues of concern. So I did meet, but I mean, to imply that somebody who worked for the Scottish Government, you know, in terms of 6 years ago, that's somehow incorrect. I mean, people have livelihoods. They work for companies. So my relationship was with the company. And that's who I met.
So you were unaware that Jennifer Dempsey worked for DFM Concerts?
No, I knew she was working for that. I think her contract finished in May.
Right. Have you met Jennifer Dempsey? Did you meet Jennifer Dempsey at the SNP conference?
Yes, I did, very briefly. And because Geoff Ellis wanted to let me know about the concerns about it, they were looking at the planning. Because it was planning, as I do with everybody, I see as a government minister, I can't discuss planning issues. He told me about ospreys and the environmental work they were doing on ospreys, but I made it quite clear that because at that time it was still subject to planning decision by Perth and Corinne Ross Council, I could hear what he was saying, but I couldn't discuss anything and I wouldn't discuss anything.
Could you maybe advise the committee who else was in attendance at that meeting?
It wasn't a meeting, it was, you know, we met briefly at conference.
Could you maybe advise the committee then who else was in that conference? When you were having a discussion with Jennifer Dempsey?
I think I had delegates from my branch.
Sorry?
Delegates from my branch, I think. I can't remember.
Okay. To go back to a question that my colleague Mark Griffin had asked about the funding, did the company at any time suggest that they would pull the plug if they didn't get the funding?
They said that their shareholders were giving them pressure to look at moving the festival from being a multi-day, multi-stage. Why is a multi-stage, multi-day important? You have the tea break stage, so the likes of Biffy Clyro has broken into the music scene using that. So actually having the multi-stage arena is very important to to the success of the event for Scotland. They indicated they were under pressure to move from that to either single day, single stage, as they've been developing in Glasgow, or indeed if they wanted to have the festival in that format, they may have to move out of Scotland.
Did they suggest that they were going to pull the plug this year?
They said that they could, and I answered that question quite clearly on the 14th of August. They said quite clearly that the 2015 event could be delivered under pressure, but the additional costs faced in relation to it were a threat to its longer-term viability at its site.
With regards to the £150,000 that's been paid over 3 years with a clawback position in 2016-2017, why would you give £150,000 then? Why would you not give £50,000 and then, if need be, another £50,000 next year and the year after? Would you give £150,000 just now?
Because the costs were for the transitional costs for the venue hire for that year to establish itself, and also to make sure that the planning consultants, which again was a one-off cost in relation to that year, could be met. In terms of the level of funding, it's in par with a number. For example, the Turner Prize is about to open in Glasgow. Great event for Glasgow, very important. Also been provided with support from public funds to the tune of £150,000. The World Pipe Band Championship has £100,000 regularly, actually, rather than a one-off cost. And indeed, a number of other events, for example, the John Muir Festival received £210,000. So the amount of funding for festivals in relation to events is not any different to the kind of levels. In fact, some other events receive even further. Now, that is a question for this Parliament and for this committee. Do you believe that tourism, cultural tourism, is important? Do you think that festivals form part of our economic offer in terms of what we can provide in terms of the income or not. I believe it does, and I believe Tea in the Park is one of the biggest ones does, and I think they'll be looking very closely to see what support and where they get it from in relation to those events going forward. I think a lot of people in the events industry will be wondering what commitment people have to that part of our economy.
Yeah, I mean, I agree that the fund is really important for these iconic events that take place, but obviously there was a real concern about the process and how we get to that funding, and perhaps, you know, I don't know when I'm most likely to come back in, convener.
Well, I'll come back in. Thank you. Good morning. I wonder if I may ask about two questions. One is the business case and the other is precedence. In terms of the business case, the £150,000 that we've talked of was paid after the Tea in the Park event. So that might suggest that there wasn't a cash flow problem for the company. What do we do in terms of looking at the results after an audit if we find the company actually made a profit of, let's say, £151,000? I mean, was there any indication that in the event of them being profitable this year, there would be a clawback this year of the £150,000 that was made available to them? Second question, the second question is, what business case was presented up front regarding the whole project? And because of the iconic nature, and I find it, I disavow the notion that with Tea in the Park, which is co-joined with Scotland, that they would move. What business case was presented to afford them the £150,000, apart from, you know, some of the issues that we said because of the move? You know, in my experience, companies normally have contingencies in the event that things do not go the way that they might. So these are my two questions.
Okay, in terms of the first issue, in relation to cash flow, was something we discussed with them, because that might have been one of the issues in terms of resolution. They made it quite clear it wasn't a cash flow issue. It was a case about the profitability or indeed the success of this going forward, and they would take a kind of hard decision, which they could take, that the if the additional costs, which were considerable because of the move from Bilado, some of it... Yeah, some of it... Yes, so that is up
the additional
company.
Costs.
In terms of clearly there was anticipated costs, and that's exactly what they should have planned for and did plan for. What came quite apparent was that, first of all, in terms of the decision, it wasn't until this summer of August 2014 it became clear that an environmental impact assessment was required. I think it is the only one in terms of the planning process. They've had to go through an additional planning process that other events in moving have not had to go through. So therefore, the planning application itself, and particularly in relation to the Ospreys, the environmental impact was considerable. That wasn't anticipated at the time of a decision to take the move from Bilado in particular, and the venue hire was much more costly than necessarily they were anticipating. And therefore, in terms of the cost, it also meant because of the... I mean, I've talked about the conditions just being about the three-year. The other conditions were related clearly to the environmental impact of nesting Ospreys, etc., which reduced the footprint of what was able to be used. That in itself would reduce the numbers that, compared to previous years, would be able to attend. And also in relation, I mentioned previously about ticket sales, clearly in relation to a slowness in ticket sales, people did not know for certain that the event would take place until 8 weeks before the event. Now, people will be familiar with the marketing of Tea in the Park, and ticket sales are usually conducted way, way in advance. So it's quite clear when they came to us there was an issue there. But in relation to the projections for going forward, they made it quite clear to us that they would have difficulties in the next 2 years, and therefore they would make a decision as to whether to keep the event at Strathallan or move it elsewhere, and that either that would be to single stage, single days, and that's where obviously they've had some experience of that, and that's obviously a very profitable aspect. It doesn't help Perth and Kinross. It doesn't help the rural economy of Perth and Kinross if the event is moved to single day, single stage to the city of Glasgow. But that also is a consideration as to why, you ask the question, why is this of an interest to government? Our job in government is to...
Where was the business case to prevent that? And the other question, because of time, is previously funds have been made available from bodies like Creative Scotland, Visit Scotland, Scottish Enterprise. What approach was made to any of them?
Well, again, one of the reasons why we had to look at the funding was the availability of funding. One of the reasons that there was available funding in the events funding budget line is because the mobiles were, the cost of the mobiles were being pushed into later years, not this year. So that freed up funding, particularly for this year. In relation to funding from other organisations, the nature and the timing of this meant that they couldn't apply for the regular funding that might have been available from other events, whether Events Scotland or indeed Creative Scotland. It wasn't a new event, it was a transferring event. Events Scotland quite often would support event development and marketing. In relation to previous funding, Scottish Enterprise did provide funding in 2012-13 to undertake a feasibility study looking at alternative sites to Bolado for hosting Tea in the Park. Again, as part of that economic impact, that was something they were prepared to help support because £15.4 million to the Scottish economy is important. Creative Scotland provided funding as part of opportunity to try and introduce new art forms to a new audience. It was about audience development. That was £80,000 in 2013-14. And Visit Scotland provided additional marketing funding in relation to Homecoming 2014. Again, a big push promoting Scotland across the world. That was part of their funding. So that gives you an explanation of the funding from other public bodies.
And you had a business case for the extra £150,000?
Yes, we did. We wouldn't have approved it otherwise.
Convener, just following up Chick Brodie's line of questioning there, I mean, we've heard in response that there wasn't an existential threat to the event in 2015, that it was going to go ahead, albeit under pressure, and the concern was more about 2016-2017. Well, earlier you suggested that the impact on ticket sales was one of the concerns. Now, presumably, with an event that was then guaranteed to go ahead in 2016-2017, the ticket sales could have been managed more appropriately. And similarly, you've got an event that's sponsored by tenants, who I would have thought would have had some concerns about an existential threat to the event, or it moving to a single-stage, single-day event, and therefore presumably could have been approached in relation to their own support for the event. What consideration was given to those two factors, that ticket sales for 16-17 couldn't necessarily have been assumed to be depressed because of the uncertainties around the 2015 event?
Oh, I think that's quite you've got a lot of hypotheticals in that question.
Well, no, but can you explain to me why it would be that the event in 2016-2017 wouldn't achieve the ticket sales that had been achieved in 2014-2013?
Well, ticket sales depend on a number of things, not least the lineup in terms of the experience. Any move for a major event, indeed, for those of us who are old enough
to... You're not going to intervene on the basis that the lineup isn't very good and therefore the Scottish Government needs to step in.
I'll try and get quick questions and quick answers, but let the Cabinet Secretary finish and I'll bring you back in.
Yeah, I mean, you don't know what's going to happen in future years. Rocknest, for example, has not taken place. There's been pressures under that. I mean, festivals, it can depend on year to year. I cannot, as a government minister, forecast ticket sales for Tea in the Park in 2016 or 2017. What I think is reasonable to assume is that the first year of a move, some people may not have gone because they were concerned about the teething problems, and I think undoubtedly there were in relation to transport. I think that's one of the key concerns that people have had, but also in terms of issues going forward, I can't predict what those ticket sales will be. What I can understand is why there were pressures this time around, because if you don't know an event is actually going to take place because the planning approval for it and decision wasn't taken to 8 weeks, you can understand why ticket sales were slow in relation to this year, which also then had an impact on what would be achieved in terms of returns. So not only was there a significant increase in costs, there was also pressure from reduced returns for 2015 in particular.
Paid after the event, but let's leave that for now. In the note you've provided to the committee in advance, it suggests on 27th February, on behalf of the CEO of DF Concerts, Tea in the Park project manager, Jennifer Dempsey first contacted the private office of the Cabinet Secretary, requesting the Cabinet Secretary consider meeting with the CEO of DF Events so that she could be briefed on the plans for Tea in the Park at its new venue. I mean, I have to say, I find it incredible that the officials wouldn't know who Jennifer Dempsey is, despite the lapse in time. But then he goes on to say that on the 9th of March, a meeting didn't take place on 23rd of April, and 28th of April, again, it didn't take place. And that there was further contact through May, and that finally on the 28th of May, a meeting took place. So 3 months after, in a process that was, we're being told, being conducted with a sense of urgency, there didn't appear to be any direction from your private office to speak to officials in the major events team so that they could engage in the process, they could speak to colleagues in state aid and find out what is and what is not supportable under the current rules. And yet that process only got underway in June, at which point Mr. Coleman, in one of the unredacted bits of correspondence we've received, suggests that Article 53.5c sets out the following as eligible, including the costs of digitisation and use of new technologies and the costs of improving accessibility. So all this time was wasted exploring options for support for this, this operation simply because DF Concerts hadn't been directed by officials to go and speak to the officials who would be able to answer their questions. It all hung on a meeting with yourself on the 28th of May.
I'll answer that directly. Clearly, during the period of March and April and into May, the discussion, the issue there was the event didn't even have planning permission. The event did not have planning permission and wasn't given planning permission until, if I check the date, was it the 12th of May? It's the 12th of May the planning permission was given. And one of the, and I've repeated it, one of the issues in relation to the pressure on costs was it was the permission that was given was time limited to 3 years. So that also then pressurised the costs over a 3 year period rather than a 5 year period. It was only at that time. In relation to the request for the meeting became about funding issues.
But you were happy to have the meeting in March and in April, but it got cancelled.
That was purely about the fact that Tina Park was a major event and was moving. That was not about funding. That was to keep us in touch, and we kept a watching brief on what was a major festival that was moving from Balado, having been there for many, many years, and was moving. It clearly was of significance, and the fact that there was pressures, particularly, and it was on, I'm sure that people would have identified in terms of the news coverage, the nesting ospreys were a key issue in terms of the environmental aspects as to whether or not this event was going ahead. The meeting that I had with DF Concerts was after the decision, the planning decision was taken. I've made it quite clear until the planning decision was taken, I was not going to be involved in relation to what the decision-making process with Perth and Kinross Council were. And in terms of the cost, the cost became quite clear when a three-year limited time condition was put, and also the environmental aspects, which reduced the footprint of the festival because of the nesting ospreys. That, again, was not clear until the planning conditions of planning was made, and that was on the 12th of May.
But it wouldn't have been prudent to direct DF Concerts in the direction of officials that could have had those conversations, presumably. That wasn't considered prudent.
The funding pressures were not apparent in the March-April period. They were apparent after the planning conditions were set on the 12th of May.
But they've been requesting the meeting back in at the end of February. Well, I can ask the final question, because I'm not going to get an answer necessarily on that. In relation to the document referred to by Liz Smith previously with the track changes, it refers in Section 6 to publicity. And what was initially proposed was that the grantee shall, where reasonably practical and with the advance agreement of the Scottish Government, acknowledging all publicity material relating to the project, the contribution of Scottish ministers to its cost. And this has been changed to ministers and require to approve the form of acknowledgement of Scottish Government support for the project and the project's publicity material prior to its first publication. Does that suggest there was a reticence about acknowledging the involvement of the Scottish Government in supporting this event? Because it certainly looks like it's been toned down very considerably from what was initially proposed.
You need to repeat it to me, but it sounded fairly similar. But I'm happy to look at that. I don't think there'd be any reticence. I mean, in fact, it's, if you look go to any event that has any Scottish Government funding, you'll see the logo and you have the
I think the trademark is that whenever there's any sort of Scottish Government involvement, it is blazoned all over the place. Whereas this is suggesting that if there is to be any acknowledgement, the Scottish Government want prior approval of whatever goes out, as opposed to demanding that in all publicity an accredited is given to the involvement of the Scottish Government in supporting it.
I'm struggling to see the issue here, genuinely.
We're all struggling a bit.
Cabinet Secretary, I'm looking at the timeline of events here, page 3, the 14th of May. It's quite a strong phrase to use, extreme difficulties being faced by the organisers. Was that purely financial?
No, a lot of that was operational because, again, the planning permission was given 8 weeks before, so there were issues around, again, probably most importantly, the infrastructure that was required. So some of the conditions of planning would have required issues around heights of bridges or safety issues or aspects of, I mean, what I mentioned, water access. So to, you know, a lot of the decisions could only be taken once you knew that planning, you know, the planning application was approved. So the pressures they would have had would not have just been financial pressures. It was genuinely operational pressures to put on what is the biggest music festival in Scotland, having only been given the go-ahead for that 8 weeks before the actual event. But, you know, that's not an area that I, you know, they relayed their concerns to me when I met them. But in terms of our concentration of attention, it was the funding and financial pressures that they were clearly wanting to talk to us about.
Reference has been made to the infrastructural costs and additional infrastructural costs accruing from the movement from one site to another, and also about the contraction of the period from 5 years to 3 years, yeah, during which they could recover those costs. Infrastructural costs, I mean, I have no experience in these sort of events, but infrastructural costs, what would that be in terms of what's happening on site?
Well, I mean, it's a decision about whether to have permanent provision or temporary provision. Temporary provision means that they could up sticks and leave at any time. Investing in permanent equipment for infrastructure would be more committed to the site. And I think that was the type of decisions they were saying to us they were having to take within 8 weeks of the event taking place.
You've already made very clear the sort of contracted period in which these decisions were being made. Normally, these events would be planned very much in advance, and I see a lot of planning did take place well in advance. However, most of the financial planning and so on would have taken place a year or more before. The only thing that I would have thought would intervene in terms of unanticipated costs would be the planning. So, did the actual planning costs trigger the financial difficulties, or was there an indication previously in relation to their what detailed planning they did previously that indicated a problem?
Well, remember, they were told very early on, I think in early 2014, that they wouldn't require the planning permissions that were later imposed on them. It wasn't until summer of 2014 that, as a result of a government assessment, they were told they would have to have the environmental impact assessment as part of the procedure. They then had to go to the full planning process at the beginning of the year that they were actually meant to be delivering the event itself. And obviously the environmental aspects of planning in particular, as well as other planning issues, would have put a considerable pressure on the costs that were unanticipated. So yes, the planning consultants' costs that they had to face for 2015 were not anticipated a year and a half out from the issues that they had to address. So clearly there was particular pressure at that time in a very short period of time. That's why, in relation to the conditions as well, understandably, because environmental conditions are important, that a lot of these decisions, they didn't know the final conditions of planning until the 12th of May for an event that was taking place at the beginning of July.
I've got a number of members who want in, so if it could be briefly a question supplementary, starting with John.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, the process and how this award was granted. Now, my understanding is that Tina Park asked to meet you. You then agreed a figure of £150,000, and you then went for a formal request on that. Yeah. I'm just wondering how that then sits with other organisations, you know, in particular those who have been received funding, including Edinburgh's Hogmanay, the John Muir Festival, the World Pipe Band Championship, Celtic Connections, and the International Book Festival. Now, which of those organisations and any others who have received state aid applied after meeting with you as Cabinet Secretary?
Festivals you required wouldn't be classified as state aid. Perhaps, Alan, can I ask you to come in about the process that's required for state aid? Would that be helpful?
No, I don't want an explanation in state aid. I just want to kind of get to the point about, you know, when people meet with you. So my question to you is, how many people have you met before an application was made from these organisations that I spoke to?
Right. In terms of the applications, many of these applications are to organisations Visit Scotland or Creative Scotland, or indeed Event Scotland in different areas. If you want me to go through who I've met in relation to these events, I regularly meet with festival directors, regularly. The Expo Fund, for example, which is not £150,000 over 3 years, is actually £2.25 million on a yearly basis to support the Edinburgh festivals because of the economic impact, £250 million the Edinburgh festivals have in relation to the Scottish economy. I regularly meet with the directors in relation to the, they provide an information as to what they want to apply for in relation to the Expo Fund. I charge the decision-making, the curatorial decision-making about what would merit or not for the Book Festival or anywhere else with the Sundering Hoos, which is the collective of the festivals. My officials would work with them. I would see what it was that they were wanting to provide their funding for. So, for example, the Edinburgh International Festival's James Play is extremely successful, was one that I was aware of way before it was announced or applied, but I don't judge what they spend their resource on in terms of that. Festivals are very important to Scotland's economy. I want to repeat this. I do not think that festivals, tourism and the creative industries and cultural tourism are somehow second class in relation to the economic impact compared to life sciences or indeed energy or other areas. And I think it's really important that members of this committee support that. And I might want to add in terms of what the public think of this. I've had two pieces from across Scotland in relation to concerns about the funding of this. Now, I'm not saying it's not of public interest. I think the committee is absolutely entitled to have information and we need to be open and transparent. And that's despite the fact that the question I received at the end of July, beginning of August from Liz Smith was very limited in its scope. I set out very comprehensively what the background to the decision, why we'd made it, and indeed a timeline information on the 14th of August, because I wanted to be open and transparent, because this was in a different format than, you're right, that we would normally have, because this was unanticipated costs and pressures on a major event that weren't known until the decision of planning was made on the 12th of May.
Thank you. So when you meet these other organisations, do you then formally agree what the amount of grant is going to be?
Do I then tell them, sorry?
Do you agree to grant before a formal application is made?
Well, it operates in a different... When you've got planned expenditure for festivals, for example, the World Band Championships is something that I wouldn't see the application. It goes to Event Scotland. Perhaps you might explain the World Band Championship.
Yeah, I mean, Event Scotland run a number of programmes, each of which have criteria. Typically, events, we would route them through Event Scotland to apply for their funding. In the case of this instance, the Event Scotland Director of Visit Scotland's budgets were already fully committed, and as the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, it didn't meet some of their criteria in terms of new events or marketing of events.
Thank you. I'm going to move on. I've got Mary first.
I'm not finished.
I'm sorry, John, but let's say to you. Mary.
Said to, in answer to George Adam and Gordon MacDonald, Cabinet Secretary, that you didn't know the request came from Jennifer Dempsey. And yet, I haven't got the 628 pages in front of me here, but at a very quick glance, Jennifer Dempsey, there's a list of emails to your office. 27th February, referring to a discussion on the phone to your office, the 9th of March, the 24th of March, and then the 14th of April. Hi, we actually caught up with Fiona at the SNP conference. So, you know, my question is, between what the little I've got here, February, and you making the decision on the 14th of August, when did you know that the application was from Jennifer Dempsey? And the 7 weeks that were critical, if it was 7 weeks it was critical to give them the money, then why did it take them 6 months to apply for planning permission? They were told they would need it on the 21st of August and they submitted a planning application in January. So the time lag is not the taxpayers' fault. The time lag and the problems and the extreme difficulties are the fault of DF Concerts. So when did you know the request came from Jennifer Dempsey?
I didn't, because my
emails
decision
are
was
all
based,
to your office.
Well, I don't read. Can I just say that in terms of the applications or phone calls, that's to my office. It's not to. I didn't see.
Do they
I've
not
been
tell
quite
you
clear.
What they do?
I've been quite clear. Look, I don't decide who DF Concerts employ or not employ. Jennifer Dempsey was an employee of DF Concerts. She hasn't worked for the Scottish Government for 6 years. I don't expect everybody in the Scottish Government, the thousands of civil service that we have, to know who she is or to alert me. I don't think people should have to show a party card in trying to work for their employee. I think that would be an incorrect situation. In terms of the decision-making process, I met with Jeff Ellis and the Financial Director, Joe Black. It was those two that I spoke to. It was they who expressed the concerns about the conditions that they faced, the increased unanticipated costs, and indeed the pressures on revenue. And it was in answer to them and to their request that I asked officials to look and see what would happen. Officials also attended the meeting with Jeff Ellis and Joe Blythe and heard directly from them. We asked them for various bits of information. I've set it in the timeline when we asked them for information. We asked them for financial information, which we have received, but under commercial confidentiality, I cannot share that publicly. That is part of the everyday work that government has. Was this an unusual situation? Yes, it was unusual. It was a pressured situation. It's why I've made quite clear and transparent in my answer on the 14th of August why we did what we did. And I believe that it's important to the interests of Scotland that we have a continuing tea in the park that is multi-stage, multi-day, that benefits rural Scotland, not just city Scotland. And I'm pleased to be able to have done that.
Of tea in the park, but the fact is, you said to Gordon MacDonald you didn't know the request came from Jennifer Dempsey. We have in front of us emails from Jennifer Dempsey to the Cabinet Secretary as early as February, and probably even further back if I had time to go through the 628 pages.
I did not see those emails.
Pardon?
I personally did not see those emails. I personally did not discuss
funding. Did your office
funding.
Not tell you within a couple of days, there's about four or five emails, do your office not tell you about phone calls, about emails, about requests for meetings?
I was told by my office that Jeff Ellis, the chief executive of DF Concerts, wanted to meet with me.
On the previous question I had, wouldn't all the hysteria around this have been avoided if we hadn't used the bodies that are there, the Creative Scotlands, the Visit Scotlands? Wouldn't it have been better, rather than have somebody approach you directly, no matter how well they knew you or didn't know you? And can we look at this going forward so that we avoid this situation?
Matt Malcolm. The answer is if it was anticipated, then yes, you would be able to use other bodies to do this. But we had the funding available in the major events budget because of the change in circumstances of the mobiles. That released the funding that was available. We had the legal powers to do it, and we wanted to move swiftly. We had a very limited period of time. It would have taken much longer if people had to apply through the regular funding of Creative Scotland and Event Scotland. And I've said also, in terms of the funding that Event Scotland provided, it wouldn't necessarily have been applicable
with all due respect, I understand you said it would take longer. That depends on how it's managed. There was nothing stopping a movement of budget. I still don't understand why there's a separate budget. Incrementing the budget of Creative Scotland, if it's them, overnight to say, right, you handle it. From a management point of view, mm-hmm. It would have avoided, as I say, all the hysterics around, your office getting sucked into this, who did what, who didn't do what. And as a suggestion, going forward, might I humbly suggest that this is what is done.
Well, in terms of swift decision making, sometimes in government you have to make decisions swiftly to ensure the economic impact and interests of the country are protected, which I did. In relation to being able to channel it through other funding, I know what would have happened. The funding for this, again, I would have been in front of committees because people said either the event didn't take place in 16-17. I think the interest of the committee would be absolutely strong wrong in wanting to have me in front of committee had the events not taken place, but also in relation to the funding. If we transferred it from the major events budget into Creative Scotland, there would still have been an issue around state aid because it would have come from a public funding source. So there would still have been a state aid issue, and that would have meant that in terms of what they were allowed to spend funding or not, Creative Scotland, in terms of what they would normally provide funding for, or indeed what Events Scotland would normally provide funding for, wouldn't necessarily have covered the eligibility of costs that would have been compliant with state aid. So actually, in terms of transparency, clarity, and indeed ensuring compliance with state aid, this was actually a route that was appropriate and indeed has been deemed to be appropriate by those that have looked at this.
Yeah, I mean, just to add to that, the budget, the Cabinet Secretary's major events team, just budget, typically is used for things that are slightly out of the ordinary. In this instance, Events Scotland might have been a route, you're absolutely right, could have looked to increase their budget. Their funds were all committed, and but beyond that, the criteria of their funds require you know, the event to be new or developing, or it to be around the marketing and promotion of the event, which in this case it wasn't.
Yeah, just to ask you, Cabinet Secretary, when and where you first met with DAF Concerts to discuss the issues around Tina Park and who attended?
In terms of discussions, I had I met them at the conference, which was not pre-arranged, which was just about them telling me about their planning process, which I couldn't engage with in discussion because clearly that was still subject to planning discussions. That was very, very briefly back in March. The time I actually met them was as detailed on the 28th of May, and that was the request where they wanted to discuss funding. Attendees at that meeting, if I check, it would be Jeff Ellis and Joe Blythe, and there was an official from planning, and also Malcolm attended. Was there anybody else in that meeting? It was Helen Wood from planning who attended along with Malcolm.
Okay, and that initial that initial meeting at SNP conference, what was that date and who attended that meeting?
It wasn't a meeting, it wasn't pre-arranged. There were many people, many companies, many organisations as observers. It was we'd just gone, our party had gone from being in tens of thousands to over 100,000 members. 1 in 50 of the public are now members of our party. People wanted to see what was happening. But I was very clear that I couldn't enter into discussions about planning. That's all it was. It wasn't about funding. I couldn't enter into discussions. And I was told about the environmental work that was going on in relation to ospreys and the osprey nesting that was obviously causing them some concern, but they felt that they were had it all in hand in terms of their planning application. It was a very, very short meeting. It wasn't pre-arranged, and it was in party space, not in government space.
Okay. From the FOI responses that were released last night, it says that an official meeting was arranged to discuss issues around Tina Park, but it was then cancelled because you had met at SNP conference. It would seem that that meeting at SNP conference was more substantive, since a subsequent official government meeting was cancelled.
Some of the government meetings were cancelled because there were concerns around the planning and the timing, because I think if you recall, the planning decision itself by Perth and Kinross Council was put back. It was meant to be at a certain date, and then it was it was put back. So I'm not responsible for the timing of that. Diaries, meetings with ministers have to be arranged. Because of my responsibilities, I quite often have to cover for either the First Minister or the Deputy First Minister. I can't recall why they were cancelled and at whose request. I do remember DF themselves wanting to cancel because they wanted to concentrate on the planning issues in hand with the Perth and Cross Council. That was the key issue. Because remember, at that point, it wasn't clear whether planning permission would be given or not given, and their focus quite clearly was about securing a favourable planning decision, and that's where they concentrated their resources. I'm not accountable for their diaries as to how they managed them, but I could understand that they wanted to focus on meetings in relation to the immediate planning decision rather than the overall transition, which was of interest in discussion with myself.
Okay, but the FOI responses suggest that the meeting was cancelled at the request of Jennifer Dempsey after meeting with yourself at SNP conference. Given that we're time limited, my last question is, do you understand the public concern around this, given that a former SNP government advisor, meets yourself at SNP conference, makes a request for funding based around infrastructure, and then gets awarded £150,000 on a totally different area of spending. Can you not understand the public outcry and the whiff of cronyism that comes off this whole affair?
Well, in terms of the individual, she worked for the government over 6 years ago. In terms of her status, she's an employee of DF Concerts. It's up to DF Concerts who they employ as staff members of their organisation. I can't refuse to work with an organisation because of who they employ or who they don't employ. And in relation to why I should meet them, should I have met DF Concerts? Absolutely, because they are a major events company. They were in a major transition year, a very pressured year for the biggest event, music event that we have in Scotland. And, you know, being kept in touch and up to date with the process of that as the lead minister for major events was part of my responsibilities. Absolutely. In terms of the application was made by DF Concerts themselves, and as far as public outcry is concerned, I understand the need for openness and transparency, which is why, despite the question that I had from Liz Smith in August being simply about, you know, how much and when, I myself proactively laid out in a full answer, in parliamentary answer to Parliament, full information about what happened and when. I raised at that point issues around viability. And in terms of the public outcry, as I said, I've had two letters from members of the public about the funding issues. And the other letters, I think there's another three, are about, understandably, the event management, the pressures, the problems they had at the actual event. So absolutely, I understand that people can be concerned. They're quite right to be. But I also know, absolutely, that had Tea in the Park been under pressure, had not delivered properly in 15, or indeed moves in 16 or 17, people would have demanded to know what we as a government had done to ensure that Tea in the Park stayed as a multi-stage, multi-day venue in rural Scotland. And I think they would have been entitled to ask that question. Sometimes you have to make decisions that some people might not like, but it's important for the greater cultural interests of Scotland and the economic interests of Scotland, and that's a decision I took.
Thank you very much. Briefly, Liz Smith.
Just on that theme, to pick you up on the fact that Tea in the Park is a major cultural event, very important event, this was public money. And if you were clear that there was a cast iron business case for that £150,000, can I ask why you didn't, at the time when other questions were being asked, when this fuss really blew up 2 months ago, decide to put that business case into the public domain? And why now do we have redacted comments which make it almost impossible to know what that cast iron business case is?
Well, the concerns were the additional and significant costs in relation to the planning issues of the 12th and the planning decisions of the 12th of May. In the answer that I provided, I made it quite clear that it was in relation to the added pressures, that it was a one-off grant, it was to support the transition, and it was about ensuring we're supporting tourism, and that the risk, the pressure and the risk was laid out in paragraph 8 and indeed paragraph 11 of the answer in the 14th of August. Would I like to be able to provide the commercial in confidence figures that were given to me? Of course I would, but that's not how government works. It doesn't work with this company and it doesn't work with others. Companies will not come to us when they are at risk if they think we're about to publish the pressures that they face in terms of their budgeting. You've got to understand that that happens in other areas of industry, which people understand quite readily, where jobs and the economic interests are set out. People just sometimes find it difficult to understand cultural festivals and tourism as if it's an economic business in order to do that. Yes, I would have liked to provide those information to you. I couldn't, but I can give you assurances that officials looked at this very robustly. We ensured that in terms of compliance with state aid, that it was compliant, and indeed we had the senior accountable officer to sign off the final grant when it was provided. As much assurances as I can give you, I have done. It might not satisfy you because you want to see the information I can't provide you, and I wouldn't be able to provide it for other companies, whether it's in life sciences, whether it's in other areas in terms of companies, in terms of their issues.
I think on your advice to Jeff Ellis, from the letter that was written to him in July 2015. I think you'll find under paragraph 5.2 that you might actually be forced to put all this on the record because it says very clearly there that through freedom of information material, the Scottish Government may have to come clean given this was public money.
Yes, and that's what we've done.
John?
I'm sure Cabinet Secretary, you will agree that suspicion will continue and linger as long as evidence is hidden. But my final question is, did any civil servants question the deal?
Well, I asked my colleagues that they were part of this in terms of we questioned what was eligible because Glasgow City Council had already provided £200,000 over a two-year period. I also going to make clear they've asked that should this detail be shared with the committee, they would want it to be known that the funding provided by Glasgow City Council was a commercial arrangement between GCC and DF Concerts and Events to establish the summer seasons on a level commercial footing so that in future years they would generate money for the city, a very similar situation of a transition, but they want to make that clear. So one of the issues was what we could provide, because we couldn't provide de minimis state aid, we couldn't provide investment state aid, but we could provide operational state aid. But perhaps Malcolm or Alan, you might want to come in on this.
I mean, I think in terms of the advice we provided the Cabinet Secretary, we'd firstly confirmed that funding would be available. It was affordable within our budgets. We confirmed that having had the Scottish Government's Finance Directorate look at the company accounts, that the company was profitable, but also that the projected costs for the event did show significant increase in costs and significant reduction in revenues. We were concerned about state aid, and in the initial advice had confirmed, as Cabinet Secretary outlined, that investment aid for infrastructure costs and de minimis aid were not appropriate means of providing support. And we also confirmed that we were looking to see if there was any other in-kind support we might be able to provide the company in relation to the staging of the event.
Could I just
add that, excuse me, the core of our work in the state aid unit is to robustly question everything that comes our way to make sure it fits with the European Commission's guidelines, and that's what we did.
Could I perhaps then ask the convener why in some of the FOI papers that an official said that Tea in the Park is a profitable commercial festival, and as such, under normal circumstances, there is limited scope for public financial support?
Because, as you just heard, we knew that the company was profitable. The issue was about the event, not the company, and the pressures that weren't normal about the circumstances of this event. It was moving for the first time for decades and had additional pressures in terms of that transition and unanticipated costs related to the planning conditions that were only came apparent on the 12th of May. So it wasn't normal circumstances.
I mean, I read with interest the email from the accountable officer, which was, I think, one of the few that was not redacted at all. I mean, it did seem unusual. It's not standard practice and does suggest, as I think John Pentland was indicating, that there must have been some level of disquiet amongst officials. But you set out the fact that you had the powers, that you had the budget, and you had the interest in ensuring that the festival took place, not just this year, but in future years, that it didn't get effectively downgraded to a single day, single stage event. I mean, similarly, tenants as the sole sponsor would have had an interest in ensuring that it remained a multi-stage, multi-day event. In what Malcolm Pentland just outlined of the due process of looking through the accounts, the profitability, the additional pressures, there wasn't any mention of any attempt to ascertain the willingness of the sponsor to step in and provide additional support through this transition and what efforts were made. Just because we have the powers and the budgets and the interest in supporting it shouldn't necessarily mean that the public steps into the shoes where a lead sponsor, tenants, exceptionally profitable company could, I think, reasonably be expected to shoulder up for something in order to maintain an event through which it has received enormous benefit and publicity over the years.
That would be a matter for DF Concerts and tenants in but terms no, of their,
it must be
their
a
relationship.
It must be a matter for Scottish Government. If you're going to go down through the process of putting in £150,000 to ease those pressures, presumably you would need to satisfy yourself that all other options have been exhausted, including asking tenants to front up a bit more to transition into 2016-2017?
Well, clearly in terms of the pressures, the 150,000 did not go anywhere near alleviating the other pressures that were there that we know from infrastructure and the aspects that we couldn't fund. But in terms of the relationship that DF Concerts has with in terms of tenants and in terms of their discussions, that's the discussions they will have had with them. They will have had pressures that have had to meet in that seven-figure amount that they're having to, they had to provide for the transition. They would have had to met them from all the sources that they had. The 150,000 from us was specific and quite clearly in terms of the clawbacks is conditional on that festival taking place in 15.
I appreciate 15, 16, it's tied. 17. It's tied, and there's clawbacks and all the rest of it, which would make any funding from tenants probably a good deal more appealing. But actually, there is a responsibility on Scottish Government and Scottish ministers to satisfy themselves that all other options had been fully exhausted, and satisfy yourself as to the reasons why tenants aren't prepared to fill and plug that gap before any public funds are committed by the Scottish Government.
The company themselves, DF Concerts, provided us with their projected costs and their projected revenue in terms of whether it's in sponsorship or indeed in ticket sales or in terms of what they anticipated for the event, and that was what was the information that was provided to
us. Well, as you say, I mean, you can't influence ticket sales because those are dependent on other factors. You would hope that in 2016-17 they return to previous
stands. I'm glad you now realise I can't influence ticket sales.
But your expectation would be in 2016-2017, with other things having been resolved, the planning requirements and the environmental impacts and all the rest of it, that there was a fair chance that those would recover. But I think there is a reasonable expectation on the Scottish Government to explore whether the sponsorship could be temporarily increased in order to plug a gap that you yourselves had identified. And just because you've got the power and the budget and the interest in ensuring this takes place doesn't mean you should be committing public funds before satisfying yourself of that.
Well, you know, at the end of the day, you've got to decide, do we think that Tea in the Park contributes to the Scottish economy in the way that members from all parties said it did in relation to the debate we had in this Parliament, recognising that it's important that we support festivals that provide cultural tourism, and particularly in rural areas of Scotland, and also provides an opportunity for the cultural celebration and the cultural tourism of Scotland. That is not an unreasonable thing to do. It is not an unreasonable thing to do. In answer to John Pentland, was this normal circumstances? No, it wasn't normal circumstances. Did we act in the benefit and the interest of the Scottish people we're elected to represent? Yes, we did. Do we interfere with the relations that DF Concerts has with its other sources of funding? No, we didn't interfere with that. But we had quite clearly a responsibility to act. We could have said no. I think many people in this in this committee may have wanted us to for other reasons, because of the unpopularity for some people in rural Perthshire of having the Tea in the Park relocated there. But for many, many people in Scotland and for generations, Tea in the Park is something that is important to them, both in terms of culture and the economy. And sometimes in government you have to make decisions, and sometimes within a tight period of time, but if it's legal, if it's something that can be provided for, if it was within budget and it's something that was compliant with state aid rules, in which case this was, it was a decision that I was prepared to take. Some people might not have wanted us to do that, and they're entitled to their view, but sometimes you have to assess risk. And as I set out on the 14th of August in my answer, there was a risk to the viability going forward of a multi-day, multi-stage festival held in rural Perthshire. And my decision was that we had to do something about that rather than ignore it, because I'm sure members of this committee would have been first to challenge me had we stood back and done nothing. And in future years, Tea in the Park isn't as we know it today.
Thank Cabinet Secretary and officials for the attendance this morning, and I'll suspend briefly to allow us to change the witness panels. Thank you. Our next item is an evidence session from the Scottish Funding Council, and this is continuing our work on examining the spending decisions made and outcomes delivered by some of the key public bodies within our remit. Can I welcome to the committee this morning Laurence Howells, Professor Alice Brown, and Dr. John Kemp, all from the Scottish Funding Council, and I believe that Professor Paul Hagan is actually on his way. Is that correct? Okay. I'm sure he'll join us shortly. And can I invite some brief opening remarks from Laurence, is it yourself?
Okay.
Is yourself, Alice, right, okay.
Good morning, Convener, and good morning to the committee, and apologies for Professor Paul Hagan's late arrival. He's been on a train from Glasgow since before 7 o'clock this morning, so a bit of a challenge. We very much welcome the opportunity to meet the committee this morning, and you'll be relieved to know that I won't repeat the content of our submission, but I just want to make a few brief opening comments. However, I would like to draw your attention to my introductory remarks on the first two pages of our submission, where we provide just some examples where, working with our partners, we have added value in different ways, whether it be widening access, skills development, the development of innovation centres, or indeed growing the research excellence in Scotland. Can I just step back for a moment, though, and look at the foundation and on the establishment of the Funding Council? When I became chair of the Council, I was told there was a book in the cupboard that provided a history of university funding. As you can imagine, this was not exactly a bestseller or a riveting read, but nonetheless, what it does point out is that the Funding Council and its counterparts in England, Wales and Northern Ireland can trace the roots back to 1914, where the objective of the state at that time was to provide sustainable funding in recognition that there was a need to support universities after the consequences of the First World War. So we can trace our roots right back to then. Now, if we move to much more recent times, you'll be aware that the current Scottish Funding Council is a merger of the former Scottish Further Education Funding Council and the Scottish Higher Education Funding Council in 2005. And our function is to secure the coherent provision of high-quality further and higher education and research, and we have a duty to ensure that provision is made for assessing and enhancing the quality of funded post-16 education. So the Funding Council's decisions support the delivery of the Scottish Government's National Performance Framework and also its economic strategy. The Scottish Government sets national priorities and issues guidance to the Funding Council based on its priorities and its policies, and it is for the Funding Council to implement such guidance, and we do so following discussion with our key stakeholders. And I think it's worth just saying a couple of words about who our stakeholders are, because they're quite extensive. Now, clearly, the sectors that we cover, colleges and universities specifically, are key stakeholders, including staff, trade unions, students through NUS and Sparks, and representative bodies like Colleges Scotland and University Scotland, but also the broader education system as a whole. Secondly, clearly, Scottish Government and Parliament are stakeholders, as is local government, and indeed the UK government, particularly through the Department of Business, Innovation and Skills. Again, other NDPBs and public agencies, such as Scottish Enterprise, HIE, SDS, Creative Scotland and so on, are key stakeholders, and we work very extensively with them. Also, other funding bodies in other parts of the UK, they are observers at our board meetings. They're key stakeholders because we have to be aware of developments elsewhere. And other relevant organisations such as learned academies, research councils, research charities, European Commission and professional bodies, so a whole range of stakeholders. And what we try to do is work with all our stakeholders to ensure the delivery of high-quality education and world-leading research. If you like, examples of extreme collaboration, I think, are evident in our submission to you. Now, change has not ended there because, as you are aware, change in the role has also developed with the introduction of outcome agreements in 2012, also with college regionalisation and ONS classification. With more focus on outcomes, such as widening access or international competitive research, this involves much more engaging and negotiating with individual institutions. There's also been a change in the significant enhancement of activity to promote exploitation of research for economic and societal benefits through, for example, our innovation centres. So as a result, outcome agreements provide an explicit link between public investment and delivery on Scottish Government priority areas. But they also facilitate a relationship-based engagement between us and our stakeholders, and it promotes dialogue and enhanced mutual understanding of the issues so that when we engage with individual universities or colleges, it provides new opportunities to learn firsthand some of the pressures that they're facing, but also their ambitions and their aspirations. But this has all meant a significant organisational change for the Funding Council itself and a change in the role of the staff within that organisation. And the reform is ongoing. We have a new strategic plan for 2015 and 18. Our last strategic plan very much outlined the changes to be made. The new one focuses on embedding these changes and realising the full potential of the changes. We're also implementing the Scottish Government's three-step improvement framework for Scotland's public services, and this all means ongoing organisational change for us as an organisation. So our vision in this plan is to make Scotland the best place in the world to learn, to educate, to research and to innovate. And we see our task as caring for, if you like, and developing the whole system of colleges and universities and their connections and contribution to Scotland's education, social, cultural and economic life. Now, we can't do this alone, and that is why partnership working is central to this, and much greater collaboration from all parties concerned. The theme of our strategic plan is ambition, and what we'll be doing is building on the strong foundations that currently exist. So I now pass over to my colleagues, Laurence and Paul, who's thankfully arrived, and John Kemp, and we're delighted to answer your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Brown, and can I welcome Professor Hagan?
Thank you very much.
No, just the Parliament to Edinburgh. I believe you've had a bit of a journey this morning, Professor Hagan, but you know, I'm glad you made it. And can I just take this opportunity to apologise for the delay in hour getting round to you? I think we said you would be on a slightly earlier on this, but thank you for waiting. But can I begin the questioning with George Adam?
Fiona, good morning. I would like to ask about the outcome agreements. You mentioned it there, Alice, when you were talking. It's obviously universities are explaining how they actually are living national priorities. Now, with the outcome agreements, if they focus more on outcomes, are we doing enough to actually wind in access by using the outcome agreements as a process?
I think the outcome agreement process is a process of discussion and debate between us and the universities. And the beauty of the outcome agreement approach means we can tailor things to different institutions. There's always more that we can do, but it's clear that the sector is making progress in widening access, but there's more that needs to be done. And as you know, there is currently a commission on widening access which will give new impetus to that. There has been significant progress in terms of improving access, steady and slow. More needs to be done. And there's been really good progress in terms of the relationship between different parts of the education system, colleges and universities, but also schools and universities. And perhaps it's best if I pass over to my colleague, John Kemp, to give a little bit more detail on that part.
Your question was, is enough being done? And as Laurence has said, there has been progress on widening access over the last decade since we published Learning for All, which was our widening access strategy. And that has been fairly slow and steady in some areas, but more recently, in the last few years, the progress on widening access to people from the most deprived areas has speeded up slightly since the outcome agreements came in. There has been more significant progress in areas like... can you hear me? There has been more significant areas in progress in areas like articulation, where the numbers articulating, that is, entering university with an HN qualification, has doubled in recent years. The question of whether it's enough, the First Minister has set out an aspiration which she's tasked the Commission for Widening Access with looking at to by the time a child born last November is entering university, that they have an equal chance of entry regardless of which deprivation quintile they come from. And that is quite a substantial change, and so that quite a lot will need to be done over the remaining 17 and a half years before that deadline is reached. But we are working with the Commission for Widening Access on ways that that can be done.
On a regular basis, that it seems to be certain universities are doing a lot better than others. Is there an explanation for that, or is it because some of the more modern universities just it seems to be easier for people from certain backgrounds to access these universities, these institutions? Yeah.
All of our universities are different. They all face different challenges in widening access. Some universities take in a significant number of their students through articulation. Sometimes one in five of their students are coming through that route. And that does make it easier to widen access, because the HE students in colleges actually are slightly overrepresented from the more deprived quintiles. So articulation is a big reason why some universities have different figures from others. It is also the case that some universities have higher demand for particular courses, which make it more difficult to widen access, because they have a lot of students with 5As in their hires who all want to study medicine, so it's more challenging to widen access in areas like that. In our support for widening access in universities, we have a range of types of support which are partly aimed at getting articulation to work well, partly aimed at improving retention for access students, but also aimed at the very high demand subjects and ways that we can work with schools to help prepare people so that they can compete with on courses where demand is extremely high.
One final question. University of Scotland have said that outcome agreements are focused on the Council's relationship with individual institutions, with a risk that they are inadequate to address shared strategic opportunities. What did University of Scotland mean by that?
I think it's the balance between... I can't speculate what University of Scotland means, but from my perspective, I think it's making that balance between an individual set of relationships and systems that we make across the system as a whole. Outcome agreements undoubtedly do focus more on individual institutions and their contribution, but they also recognise the fact that each individual institution in its locality providing the service is individual, and we think it's important to get that balance right. I think we see the balance as being there are some things that are about what individual institutions do and what they contribute, and there are other things about how we can work in partnership maybe across institutions. So, for example, all of our activities in research pooling and our activities in innovation centres are partnerships across multiple groups of institutions and trying to get those strategic things right. So I think what University of Scotland is referring to is, well, have we got the balance of those two things absolutely right? And I think it's a thing that balance needs to change over time, depending on the issues of the day. My view is that we have got the balance right, that there needed to be a shift away from uniform national policies to policies that were more focused on individual institutions. Thanks.
Can I just add to that slightly? Yes, Laurence's point is about how do you balance the diversity, which is important, one of the strengths of the Scottish system, with making sure that you've got a strategic approach that all are signed up to. And in relation to widening access, because there's lots of other examples where we do this strategically, but in relation to widening access, the learning for all that John referred to, we hold an annual conference with principals of all the universities, and we're planning the next one now. And I think for me, that's a very valuable way of bringing them together to collectively share some of their direct experiences, but also think more strategically as a collective, as well as how individually as institutions within their different parts of Scotland and recognising the different pressures that they're under can respond.
Would that strategic joint working actually help with the widening access agenda? Mm-hmm. Because for the very reason the questions I asked earlier on, that some institutions seem to be taking up more of the slack than others. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, and you'll find that on the Commission there's representatives from different universities on the Commission, and also I should point out that within the Funding Council we have our own Access and Inclusion Committee. It's an excellent committee, it is very up to date and at the forefront of some of the strategic discussions on all of this, so we play our part in different ways, but very much much in partnership with the different principals. In addition to outcome agreement meetings, it's also worth stressing that the board gets an opportunity, along with members of the executive, to visit all our universities and our colleges. I know you're going to look at colleges another day. Where we have what's called strategic dialogue meetings. And again, it's another opportunity to for our board to be up to date and aware of some of the developments, but to have these kind of strategic discussions that are so important when choices have to be made in moving forward. So I think there's different ways in which this operates.
Laurence, you mentioned twice, actually, in your first answer, that in terms of widening access, more needs to be done. You said it twice. What specifically does the Scottish Funding Council have to do more of in order to assist with widening access?
I guess what was in my mind was two things. Firstly, the work, more of the work that we've been doing already in terms of additional places and improving articulation between universities and colleges so that there is a clear route through. And I think the second thing is in terms of enhancing and improving and developing what's been called contextualized admissions, which is where universities take a wider range of factors into account in assessing talent and ability. So I guess those would be the kind of two priorities that we would be looking for, making that system as a whole work better and thinking about how individual universities look for the most talented applicants. Do you want to add anything?
There is a commission on widening access that's sitting at the moment and will report early next year, and we hope that will give some advice on what more needs to be done. But the reason we say more needs to be done is that there continues to be a disparity between the proportion of people from the more deprived areas going into higher education as opposed to the least deprived areas, and that is a fairly stark one. The government has an aspiration to address that over the next decade and a half or so, and quite a lot will need to be done to do that.
Liz Smith.
Professor Brown, you were very clear in your statement that you feel that the outcome agreements from 2012 have done a lot to increase the accountability of universities for their spend on public money, and you gave some examples of exactly how that has happened. Do you believe that there's anything else within outcome agreements that could further enhance this process?
I'll ask my colleagues to come in, but certainly my impression is that they're evolving, the outcome agreements. When they started, they were for 1 year only, and I could see the particular challenges in that when you're running big organisations. They've moved to 3 year, which I think is much better, so it allows a different kind of dialogue, if you like. But they have evolved and improved since they've been established quite considerably, and we're always looking at ways in which we might improve them. And that's where the dialogue with University of Scotland and with individual institutions is so important, because we genuinely want to be open to improving them, because I think from both perspectives, there's a lot to be gained by these. One of the first things I did when I was appointed chair was to meet with principals of universities, and clearly they wanted to ask me about outcome agreements and so on. And for me, I certainly feel that they have provided for the university sector too an opportunity for them to very clearly demonstrate to their stakeholders and indeed their communities much more generally what they do and what they and there's great stories to be told. And so for me, they're valuable in lots of different ways, not least to say in making it much more open and transparent about what.
Can I just ask on obviously universities have a huge amount of money that comes in from non-state funding, yes, from research councils, from the EU, from charitable foundations, philanthropy, etc. In terms of the outcome agreements about the accountability of that spending, mm-hmm, do you think that the outcome agreements since 2012 have improved mm-hmm the way in which universities are accountable for that kind of money?
I think we would see the priority for the accountability have been for our funding.
Yeah.
The outcome agreement is an agreement between the university and us about what our funding buys. But as well as the accountability, it's important to stress, as Alice has, the outcome agreement is a dialogue, uh-huh, between us and the institution, where part of it is an agreement, a funding agreement, that defines what it is they will do with our funding. But it's the dialogue that gets you to that when you're discussing what the priorities of the institution are and how that relate to the aims that we're seeking to promote and reaching an agreement on how we mutually fund something that takes you closer towards it. That's the main benefit of them.
So you would argue that because of the outcome agreements with your own funding, which obviously government provided, that it has helped the accountability process with other areas of funding, because obviously they're having to look at what they do well.
I think that that's certainly the case. And just to emphasise the point John made about the dialogue, when engaging with the institutions, we're anxious to hear about the ideas that they have that can improve things. And one example I've given you is the Transitions 2040 programme at the Conservatoire, where pupils who would normally have access to the Conservatoire are encouraged and supported at an earlier stage in their development, and many of them are now moving on to courses at the Conservatoire. So it's a significant exchange with the institutions. What new ideas do you have? What could we do differently? How could we support you to do that? In terms of the accountability, again, I would agree with John, accountability for SFC and Scottish Government funds is primarily the area we're interested in. But of course, the institutions have significant accountability to those other bodies. And if they don't discharge those responsibilities properly, then their funding sources will soon dry up. So it's certainly not in their interests to not pay attention to that aspect.
Thank you.
Chick Brodie.
I'm sorry about your journey. I'm sure the Minister of Transport can ask some questions. I spent some time at Stanford University in California and was overwhelmed by the partnership and the involvement and the engagement between business and university. And one of the outcomes in your strategy, and thank goodness you're talking about outcomes and not targets, the outcomes and strategic plan for 2012 to 2015 was about university-industry collaboration. I wonder if you can tell me, given the amount of public money provided to the universities, how much do you receive, if any, of the £441 million income generated by universities from knowledge exchange activities, given Scotland's poor record in terms of creating small businesses? The knowledge transfer activity is very, very important. So do you take equity participation? Do you do equity involvement? Or do you just simply give them the money and hope that something comes out the other end?
We don't take an equity share. The priority here is ensuring that businesses are supported and that our research is translated for the benefit of business and industry. Our institutions are actually pretty good at spinning out companies and creating new companies. In fact, as good as many other countries in the world. Our investment in this space is about trying to make it even better and to smooth the interaction between business and industry, which is why we've actively engaged with University of Scotland in the implementation and development of their own five-point action plan to deliver benefits for business and industry. So what matters is that we translate the research for the benefit of the economy. The economy will benefit through the creation of small companies, through growth of companies, and through the jobs that will emerge as a result of that engagement. That's sufficient for us.
So can you tell me why, I wouldn't say which university, but having talked to a professor who developed a voice unit which was way ahead of its time, and when I asked about what his plans were to transfer this to market, he showed total disinterest, frankly, this is some time ago, so, total disinterest on the basis that all he wanted to do was to go around the world presenting a paper on it.
I think our universities have moved a very long way from that, and you'll find that a very much higher proportion of academic staff and researchers in universities are now working towards the translation of the research. Many people go into research because they want to make a difference to the world in some way or other. Many of them are interested in pursuing an academic career, but the move of our universities in recent years has been towards the translation of research. That's backed up by the push from the research councils, who want to see their investment in research translated for the benefit of the UK economy in that case. And of course, the research excellence framework, which assesses the research every few years, now has an impact assessment included, and the funding that flows from the funding council is influenced by the success in that impact. And that impact is beyond the academic publication. It's in terms of the benefits to the economy, to the health and the well-being and the culture of the country.
Forgive me, Professor Hagan, that may be your view of the world. If I talk to business people, there seems to be this divide where we have the hallowed cloisters of the universities and the aggression, if you like, of creating business and pursuing it. And I also disavow your comment about we're one of the best in the world. I was involved very heavily in European business. And we're not engaging in creating that transfer of knowledge from businesses and from universities to market. There is no go-to-market philosophy, as far as I can see, and of course you'll correct me, but go-to-market philosophy in the universities.
I'll describe exactly where that go-to-market philosophy is engaged, and I'll refer you to our innovation centres. 8 innovation centres have been established to feed the demand from industry for research and development. And some major industries from within Scotland and global industries, including some SMEs, have engaged in the development of the Innovation Centre programme. And the whole thrust of that programme is having a demand-led development of research for the benefit of the economy and the people of Scotland. So already the culture of our universities is changing in that regard.
Perhaps not quickly enough, because let me ask you for specific examples when the Funding Council has influenced course provision in a way that significantly improved outcomes for employers and students. If I look at the curriculum of universities, yes, we have business media courses, but or business studies courses, but I see no real connection. There are some commercial units, I understand that. But you know, in another committee, we've been looking at internationalisation and exports, and of course I talked about the small number of startups relatively. I mean, £441 million is not a lot of money, given the reputation that we have for a research and development innovation partnership, is it? So can you give me some examples?
Comes into the universities. This isn't the money that businesses and the economy benefits from. So there are two things.
Think how much more you could do if you took an equity share, for example, in some. I mean, having that money recycled through the universities again, how much more your funding would be increased?
Some of our universities do take an equity share. The Funding Council doesn't. So in those situations, the funding that stems from those the equity share that the universities take can be recycled to support business and industry and further development of research within the institution.
Okay, thank you.
Just for clarity, since it's a couple of times and quite rightly, so why do you not take an equity share?
The negotiations, we fund research, we fund the development. The negotiations and the ownership of the IP associated with the research development lies with the institution and the researcher. It doesn't lie with the Funding Council. We would need to impose a condition of funding that allowed that to happen. And I guess one of the major issues, I think, in any business arrangement between two partners, the university and the business and industry interested in exploiting the IP, would be having another player at the table or another slice of the cake. If our universities are negotiating on a reasonable basis and they're securing the investment for the universities and they're using that in the return on that investment effectively, then I'm not sure that we necessarily have a place as a middleman. But I'm open to other opinions on this.
I'll bring you back in a second, because this is interesting. I don't think it's answering the question, to be honest, okay. Professor Hagan. I'm still not understanding why, if such an opportunity arises, is there anything to stop you doing this? Is there anything that actually blocks you from doing it in your rules or your...
I don't think we're absolutely blocked from doing that. I guess it's back to incentives and trying to keep an entrepreneurial culture in our universities, so that they're actively seeking to, you know, make these deals happen. And again, in our experience, there tends to be a myriad of deals, from very very large ones to relatively small ones. And I guess our view would be we're here to try and balance the needs of teaching, research, innovation in the economy, widening access, cultural contribution, and our role is to create a healthy, entrepreneurial, active university sector that then engages. And I think, you know, the experience of the past of universities who have had the benefit of deals from industry and money coming back means that they're then hungry for more and keen to do more and reinvest that money.
I'll bring you back in a second. Okay. I'm absolutely struggling here because, if there's nothing to prevent you from doing something like Chick Brodie has suggested. I'm struggling to understand why you wouldn't do it. In some cases, you might not do it in all cases, you might provide a grant in some cases, in other cases you might take a small equity stake, which effectively, and particularly in times of austerity and difficulty in terms of finances, that may bring money back into the system, which would increase your ability to fund other projects. I mean, surely this must happen elsewhere in the world. Why would it not happen here?
I think, again, we tend to be funding the long-term infrastructure within the universities rather than specific projects. If we were funding a very specific project, we'd be probably doing that in partnership with a whole range of other partners. I mean, it's an idea that's definitely worth thinking about. You know, what is the scope for the state benefiting from co-investment in the system? But right now, at the moment, we're trying to shift the culture so it's a more entrepreneurial one. There's more of the sort of activity you've described happening.
We're just trying to get you to be more entrepreneurial. I think that's maybe what we're struggling with. I'll just move on, though. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, very quickly, Senator.
Professor Hagan had £441 million, apart from buying a Bellio ScotRail. would he, you know, if you invested, and any investor has a right to say, I want a share of the IP, or I want this return, or I want shares in the company. We just don't do that in Scotland. And it's great news that the culture is going to change, but the fast way to change it is to say that that's what you're going to ask. So you'll demand on the public purse would ultimately be less, but an awful lot more than you're probably getting just now.
I'm happy to take away and explore the options.
Thank you.
But I would say that the research councils don't take an equity share. And if you go back to the discussion we had earlier about outcomes, the outcome is their benefit for the economy and the people of Scotland. And in this case, that's probably best discharged through company growth and the creation of wealth and jobs.
I was going to let it go there, but, you know, if you took an equity stake, what stops that being of benefit to the people of Scotland and economic growth and et cetera?
We will take it away.
Okay,
we will look at it.
Okay, thank you very much. Gordon, please. Gordon.
Just to continue this discussion about employers and higher education institutions, in your submission you said you're in a unique position to anticipate and to respond to student employer needs and gaps in higher and further education across Scotland. Now, we've heard previously that there is up to 150,000 IT vacancies across Europe, including Scotland and the rest of the UK. And in Engineering UK themselves, in the State of Engineering 2015 report, said that engineering enterprises are more likely than average to have hard-to-fill vacancies for professionals, 32% compared to 18% average. And they go on to say, furthermore, nearly half of engineering enterprises said that hard-to-fill vacancies meant they had delays developing new products or services. So given that we've got these two large areas with issues in it, and you do have an Access to High Demand Professionals National Programme, which is two projects, REACH, which is Access to Law, Medicine, Veterinary Medicine and Dentistry, and ACES, which is Access to Creative Arts and Architecture. Why isn't there a project that focuses on these STEM subjects when we know there is a huge vacancy out there?
The two projects you talk about are widening access projects. As well as that, we have a series of interventions on skills, which will tackle some of the issues you talked about. But ICT is a good example. There is an issue in Scotland with a shortage of ICT professionals. The Skills Investment Plan reckons that there's about 11,000 of a gap in Scotland, which will be part of the larger gap you identified in Europe. We had a meeting with some employers from the IT industry and the departments from our colleges and universities in May to talk about how we take forward that mismatch between what was being produced by the colleges and universities and what employers wanted. And we followed that up, I think, just the Friday before last with a meeting with the colleges and universities about how we were going to respond. And what we are encouraging them to do is come together to make sure that the suite of courses that are available in colleges and universities are ones that meet employer needs, because sometimes it's not just about numbers, it's about getting the right courses. Because one of the things that was evident when we got the employers and the colleges and universities together was that the colleges were saying, well, actually, the destination stats for people leaving our courses aren't that great, and you're saying there's a shortage, why aren't you employing them? And they were saying, well, you've not got quite the skills. So we need to match that better together. So we're going to be encouraging the colleges and universities to come together in some form of partnership, possibly similar to the Energy Skills Partnership, which is one that operates in part of the engineering sector, to make sure the courses are right, that that's badged to employers, that they know when you take someone on from that course at that university, it's got the skills you need for your job, and that crucially, students know that when they enrol on that course at that university, it will lead you into that particular part of the industry, rather than, you know, that you graduate and the employer suddenly says, no, that's not what we need. By and large, employers are happy with the output of colleges and universities, but there are some mismatches in things like ICT, and we want to work with colleges and universities to make sure that that mismatch disappears.
Good. Two points to come back on in that. You quite rightly said that your national programme, Reaching ACES, is about narrowing the educational attainment gap, but are you going to put a similar project in place for ICT and engineering?
We don't have a specific plan to use ICT as part of the widening access project, but that could... the reason we have the high demand professions projects is that in order to get into medicine or some of these creative subjects, that you need either 5 A's in your higher plus experience of working in a hospital because your parents are doctors and so on. So that's intended to address that gap rather than a shortage of doctors, because that, you know, that isn't an issue. That's not to say that you couldn't combine addressing a skills issue with an access issue as well. So we could look at that.
And the second point I was going to ask you was in relation to engineering. The same report went on to say that they're concerned about the calibre of STEM graduates also needs attention, and they say that heading the list is a troubling finding that nearly half of those respondents experiencing problems have concerns about the quality of STEM graduates, and this just ranks ahead of the problem of a shortage of STEM graduates. So is there anything that you're doing to address it? I know you touched upon it earlier.
We are expanding the number of STEM graduates. Some of our additional places are specifically for STEM, and that will increase the proportion of students at university who are studying STEM. One of the bigger issues, though, with STEM is that there is quite a lot of STEM in the system, but a lot of the people who study STEM leave and don't go into STEM industries. It's about attractiveness post-university, because they have numeracy skills which are attractive in a whole number of areas. So yes, part of it is about expanding the number of STEM graduates, and we are seeking to do that. But it's also about getting, come back to the point I made earlier, a better match between what's in the courses and what employers need. And you know, STEM graduates are attractive in a whole number of areas, not just in engineering or science courses. And actually, we probably supply far too many for simply those industries. It's getting a bigger proportion of what we do supply into the right industries.
Okay, thanks.
Just first of all, ask a question on the Scottish Index for Multiple Deprivation. I was at the West Highland College graduation on Friday, and would you not agree that in rural areas such as Fort William, Ardnamurchan, etc., it's a very crude measurement, and it really does not reflect students from poorer backgrounds, etc.? So what are you doing in order to get a more accurate reflection of students from poorer backgrounds?
We would recognise that in rural areas, the SIM doesn't work as well as it does in urban areas. And we're aware that even in urban areas, that for example, Aberdeen, the proportion of the population who are from the more deprived data zones is far smaller. So in our interactions with the universities in Aberdeen, we're very much aware of that. We don't have one target for all. In rural areas, the SIM, because of the very small populations and more mixed data zones, works particularly badly. But so we are keen that institutions use a basket of measures to describe what they're doing in widening access, some of which relate to individuals, not to data zones, and that helps give a bit of richness to understanding, you know, how well they're doing in widening access.
That needs to be done fairly quickly, because our latest paper in the Audit Committee said that UHI had 4% of students from poorer backgrounds compared to Glasgow and Forth Valley at around 35. So it does look like a poor reflection on that institution.
But rest assured, when we look at how well UHI is doing or Robert Gordon's are doing, we contextualise that by looking at the figures for where they're drawing students from and recognise that's different from Glasgow.
Well, the figure you give to the Audit Committee's portal, we'll leave it at that. Yeah. The second question is, what's your role in national pay bargaining for further education colleges?
We don't have a direct role. That's a negotiation between the colleges and their staff. Our role is limited to funding and supporting the system and from time to time reflecting on how that's actually operating and how that impacts on the operation of each college.
Well, it's government policy to have national pay bargaining, and I was also told on Friday, we're familiar with it myself, but in the UHI they are the lowest paid college and university lecturers in the whole sector. In fact, if you look at FE, the difference between a UHI lecturer and, say, James Watt, is £5,000 salary a year. The cost of living is no less in the UHI, but they cannot offer lecturers more money. They cannot fulfil the Scottish Government's national pay bargaining on a national pay scale because of the lack of funding from yourselves. Do you recognise that it is an issue, if the government want to fulfil national pay bargaining, that you're going to have to step in and either some colleges stand still for 5 years or you bring the UHI up to the level of others?
My understanding is that we're not directly involved. The discussions currently between Colleges Scotland and the unions on national pay bargaining are about equalising the pay increase each year rather than sorting out the underlying disparity immediately. But you're right, that will have an impact on institutions. But as I say, we're not directly involved, but I'm not clear, when they plan to tackle that issue.
Well, they're funded by you, and in order to pay the staff, they have to get that money or stop doing courses. My third point, convener, is really on the back of Gordon MacDonald's points, and there is a... Last week at Health Questions in this Parliament, we had 8 questions on the shortage of GPs. Other weeks, it's questions on the shortage of nurses. There's been huge media interest this week in the shortage of radiologists and many other health professionals, as well as people in STEM subjects. And we've also heard about the drastic shortage of Gaelic teachers. Now, one of your responsibilities is to look at workforce planning, look at the skills required by our economy in the future. So if you are looking at that and you're doing your job right, why have we got 29,000 fewer places in FE for under-16s, 150,000 fewer part-time places, 74,000 fewer places for over-25s, 24,000 fewer IT places, and if we go back to schools, etc., because obviously I hope you'd be talking to schools because they're not going to get into further or higher education unless they've got... the qualifications in maths, 4 and 5, part this last year, 29,000 fewer pupils sitting computing. So that doesn't exactly sound that you're on course and at one with the government or indeed the economy in meeting skills shortages. So can you address the points I've made?
Could I ask?
And for all those cuts, 3,000 additional full-time places.
Can I ask Professor Hagan to talk about the issues to do with medical subjects and then perhaps John Kemp in terms of FE places?
In terms of medical and nursing places, of course, the numbers are strictly controlled by the Scottish Government, and we implement the numbers that are given to us and arrange for the distribution of those places across the sector. The issue of the numbers of GPs and other specialised disciplines across the sector is partly an issue of the choices that students make whenever they're starting their courses and whenever they progress through their courses. There is nothing that determines that students going through medicine have to become GPs or have to become surgeons or, in fact, have to follow any particular discipline. Perhaps the solution to that problem is some incentivisation for people who go into specialised subject areas rather than determining at the outset which particular part of medicine any student would want to study in. I would expect that many of the students who start medicine generally have no idea about what particular disciplines are about and form their views on that as they progress through their course. And, of course, they'll also form those views on the basis of their particular aptitude for particular parts of the medical profession.
But there's huge cuts in the science subjects at schools and in science teachers, etc. I don't want we've heard it all in the last couple of weeks at this committee.
The panel will get an answer first before you come back in.
Well, I thought it'd finished.
No, I just wanted...
So you need to have your sciences in order to do medicine, that's my point.
On the reduction in college places, a large reason for the reduction in headcount is that there are more substantial full-time courses on offer. But often the courses that are no longer there were extremely short, and it requires quite a few of those in order to create a full-time course. You're correct that the number of courses in schools or sub-16 courses by colleges, which often were delivered in schools, has gone down. That was often very short courses, right through the kind of school career. I suspect that will go up over the next couple of years as more substantial courses related to developing the young workforce become part of what colleges do in schools. But that is partly about getting a better link between what schools and colleges do together in order to respond to employer need. We are not responsible for all of the things that are happening in schools, but colleges are working quite closely with schools on courses that vocational routes which could lead to college, could lead to university, that we think will develop quite fast over the next couple of years in responding to the youth employment strategy.
Colin.
I think the panel would probably agree that SFC has an important role in providing information and advice to Scottish ministers based on your interactions and so forth with institutions. But there's been some criticism from a number of the written submissions that we've received that the SFC has become too closely linked to the Scottish Government. I'll give a couple of examples here. University of Dundee says, at times the Scottish Funding Council has appeared to serve more as a conduit for government policy rather than as a critical buffer between government and universities. Ensuring that SFC is enabled to fulfil this role is vital to the success of our sector. And Queen Margaret University says, over the last few years, it appears the SFC's role in delivering a challenge function to Scottish ministers has been diminished. How would you respond to these criticisms?
I guess, well, firstly, our role, we have two roles, and that's clear. Firstly, one our key role is to operationalise the government priorities that we've been asked to do using working in a full range of partnerships with all of our partners, not just colleges and universities, but other partners. And that's our key delivery role in terms of us developing and improving the education system as a whole. We also do have a role in terms of providing advice to government, and the convention is we provide that advice and confidence, and we do that on a whole range of subjects very, very frequently. I am concerned if our key stakeholders, the universities and colleges, don't perceive us as being acting in an objective way to create the best system that we possibly can. And part of our continuing dialogue with University of Scotland and with universities individually is to make sure that they realise that we do understand the individual pressures on them and that we do act strategically to try and create the best possible system that's there. I should also stress that universities and colleges themselves offer advice to government themselves directly and through other bodies. It's a difficult balancing act for us to play. Our key role is to support the delivery of the government's key priorities, and that's what we put most of our focus on, and that's most of our outward focusing activities that people will see. And perhaps there's more that we need to do with individual stakeholders to make sure they understand we've understood and heard and reflected on the feedback we get from them.
Do you agree with Queen Margaret University that you should have a challenge function to Scottish Minister?
We clearly, yes, we do have a challenge function, and we operate that challenge function when we offer advice. Challenge is maybe too strong a word, but we offer advice and we say, if you wish to do X, then this is the best way of doing it, or if you want to do Y, we'll need to do this amount of you know, we'll need this amount of money or whatever. We equally say, actually, if you want the kind of innovative educational system that you want, this is the best way to achieve that.
And again, taking a phrase that was used by the University of Dundee, do you see yourself as a critical buffer? I mean,
we see ourselves as a role of being expert implementers of the government policy to create the best education system we can. And if that's the definition of a buffer, then yes, buffer isn't a word that I would use.
Yeah, it does seem a bit strong that you're a buffer between government and universities. Specifically looking at universities, where do you see your role there in terms of interfacing with the universities versus the government? Where do you see yourself fitting in there?
I think I would see us as trying to create the best connections between a whole range of stakeholders, you know, not just a binary relationship. There's the universities, there's the student body, there's the local authorities, there's the local employers, there's that whole system of education and schools as well. So I don't see it as a binary one versus the other, if you like. I think we're all combining, we've all got the same goal, which is the best education system we can possibly have in Scotland. And our role is to try and engineer that.
Could I just maybe illustrate that a little bit? I mean, we meet regularly with University of Scotland, and as I explained earlier, also with individual institutions. But if we look at one of our recent experiences, and that's on the Research Excellence Framework, I look particularly at Professor Hagan, because he and his team worked a lot with the different institutions, talking about and in consultation with them about the methods of, you know, how we'd organise funding for all of that. So we don't do these things in isolation. So when we're thinking about implementing a particular policy, it will be through that iterative process, that kind of exchange that goes on regularly with us and our stakeholders, and universities being key stakeholders here.
Do you think the comments that just these two examples have made indicate that there's perhaps any sort of misunderstanding as to the role of SFC or an expectation that's not there?
All those comments as important things for us to work on with the universities, and to go back and say, well, what did you mean and what more could we do to change that, as part of us thinking about how we improve, how we function and how we work. It is important to say that we also meet University of Scotland in a three-way meeting with ourselves, the universities and government. So, you know, we very much take the point that feedback of this sort is of value to us to learn about and to engage more about, well, how could we do it better?
In fact, one of the things, Colin, is that we're meeting later on in October. We're having a strategic meeting with the board, and I think it's always useful. I certainly find the submissions extremely useful, and we'll use some of the points in the submissions to have a discussion in the board about if that's a perception. What does the board think about that, and how might we address it?
Just very recently, 10th September, there was a letter of guidance issued to SFC. The Cabinet Secretary stated, I consider it essential that you accelerate your efforts to reform and strengthen your own organisation to ensure it's attuned to the evolving political and economic environment and the needs of our communities, capable of acute analysis and effective and efficient ways of working, and for delivering effective, high-quality leadership to the ITCHE and FE sectors it funds, ensuring that public investment delivers for learners and ultimately grows the economy. That's quite a statement there. How are you going to assess your performance against those guidelines?
Well, obviously, from my point of view, continuing improvement and development of SFC is you know, at the top of my agenda. I think the Cabinet Secretary's letter gives us a strategic framework within which to do that. We have ourselves adopted the Scottish Government's three-step improvement programme, which gives you a method whereby you can develop and improve what you do. The board, we are at the next meeting of the board, we will be presenting a new way of the board itself asking questions of the executive about how well we're doing, and those are will be put attaching measures or ways of assessing how well we're doing against that task, along with all the other tasks we've got to do.
This is quite a sweeping ask here.
Indeed, but I actually turning it back, it's only the aspiration that we would have as an organisation to be regarded in that light.
I guess I would add to Laurence's comment, we aren't starting from nowhere. We've been engaged in this for some time, and I'd give another example in terms of impact on the economy, the significant partnerships we've developed with Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands and Enterprise, and that partnership has been refined and improved over the last 3 years. And working in partnership, I think we can make a much bigger impact and deliver on some of the requests that are in the letter of guidance.
Well, I've got two quick supplementaries, one from Chick and one from Mary.
Just on that last point, because, again, I sit on another committee which looks at the economy and internationalisation with Gordon MacDonald. One of the aspects, we're talking about funding again, the Horizon 2020 European programme is worth €72 billion over the next 6 years. How are we engaging with that to develop and strengthen the Scottish economy through the university mechanism?
Two ways. The universities themselves, of course, are heavily engaged in securing Horizon 2020 funding, just as they were in FP7. And the evidence is there to show that the bulk of the funding that came into Scotland as a consequence of engagement with Europe during that period was taken by our universities, and that's on the basis of the quality, the excellence of the research and the feed into the economy. In terms of other initiatives we're taking, we have established interface, and we've mentioned interface, the link between business and industry, universities and business and industry, which is been working very successfully. We provide additional innovation vouchers that allows SMEs to engage with universities to secure Horizon 2020 funding, and that's a relatively new intervention from us.
So do you have somebody dedicated to looking at the Horizon 2020 programme, or are you working with government or Scottish Enterprise so that we access that, because it's not being a member state yet. We have to be very fast on our feet to make sure that we know what's going on.
We are proactive. We work with Scottish Enterprise, we work with Scottish Government, we work with Highlands and Islands Enterprise, and importantly, we work with and are heavily engaged with Scotland Europa. We deal directly with Mr. Swinney's team in Atlantic Quay, the Commercialisation and Innovation Group, in terms of meeting regularly with those various partners to plan out our activities in relation to Horizon 2020. We organise a series of events as a partnership around the country in advance of Horizon 2020 to engage SMEs from across the country to promote the various opportunities that would be available, and we're continuing that dialogue with them.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
BT read out the letter from the guidance from the Cabinet Secretary that you accelerate your efforts to ensure that you're more attuned to the evolving political environment. What do you have to do to be more attuned to the political environment? What does this mean?
I could take some of that. I guess from a research perspective, you'll be probably aware that there are significant discussions underway across the UK with the Nurse Review of the Research Councils with the consideration of an alternative role perhaps for healthcare. Those of you who have read the Times Higher Education Supplement will be aware of that. So it's being aware and alert to changes that are happening across the UK, in particular the impact on the research agenda. And in fact, my colleague, my Deputy Stuart Fancy, is at BIS this morning discussing these various aspects.
As far as I'm aware, the research councils are not political. That doesn't answer my question.
But they are influenced by political decisions made by BIS.
Is that what this sentence means, that you have to become more attuned to the evolving political environment? It's only related to the research councils. Is that the case?
No. Well, this is certainly a UK agenda for the research councils. And I did
Can I ask Laurence what you think it means?
I take it as the attuned to the environment that we're operating within. What is the government of the day asking us to do, not only in Scotland, but obviously in the UK where it affects us, and potentially in Europe. And maybe it's also for us to do a little bit of horizon scanning of what we see coming down the road as the environment in which we're going to be operating. And one of the very big messages that that I take from the current government is this impetus for us all to work together, as more of a system with the other partners in Scotland, and that strong drive from government. That's what I would take that as.
Thank you very much, Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Peter. I just have a couple of questions as to how the higher education sector responds to international competition. Particularly, one of the questions that were sent out to yourselves in advance was how the Fund Council provide leadership and added value to universities by helping them monitor and respond to challenges from international competitors. And the University of Edinburgh, and providing evidence, said that the SFC does not have particular strengths in looking at international competitors or in enabling universities to meet the demands of international competition. And against that backdrop, perhaps you could tell the committee exactly what the role is for the Scottish Fund Council in monitoring international competitors and how you help universities respond to that.
I don't think we are actively engaged in monitoring international competitors, so I'll be open about that. But I guess from our perspective, using the resources that are available to us, it's about ensuring our universities are resourced to be internationally competitive. And if you use a benchmark for that, the performance of the sector in the recent REF 2014 exercise, the research assessment framework, you'll be able to see that our institutions are as competitive as any across the UK. In addition, I think we refer in the documents to two publications, one from BIS and one from the Welsh Funding Council, which look at a range of metrics in terms of the research performance across the four administrations in the UK. And in every one of those metrics, Scotland outperformed the rest of the UK. So if you're asking us how do we match up against the rest of the UK in competition, I would argue that in terms of, and accepting that the UK is ahead of much of the global competition, I would say that Scotland contributes a disproportionate performance in securing the international position of the institutions across the UK.
It's worth also commenting that we're a core member of the Connected Scotland's group, which is a partnership between ourselves, the universities, colleges, British Council, and Royal Society. And that's where the expertise, particularly through SDI Scotland Development International, that's where the expertise about helping our sector to export and be effective in the world lies. And we see our role as being a supporter of that, but not the one with the key lead in leading trade missions and the rest of that.
And I can add two other things. The innovation centres have been taken out. Three of the innovation centres have been out in China, and the Chinese have been back to investigate what we're doing in terms of the innovation centres. They are taken by the model. In addition, we've had the research pools in energy and in life sciences now, following a visit to Hong Kong, now directly engaged in bilateral partnerships with them. I would also refer to the Max Planck partnership. The German Max Planck Institute doesn't form partnerships with any organisations across the world, but they have formed an international Max Planck partnership with Scottish institutions. And again, in terms of the Innovative Medicines Initiative, securing funding to establish the lead drug factory for drug discovery here in Scotland against competition from across the whole of Europe and indeed across the rest of the UK, I think indicates that the investments we've made make our institutions internationally competitive.
Appreciate that you've given a list of examples as to what you do and to make institutions internationally competitive, and given examples of where you've been able to successfully export. But do you have no role in monitoring what competitors are doing, for example, how successful they are in their initiatives to export expertise, to attract research funding? Is there no role for the Funding Council to see what competitors are doing and possibly to be taking their initiatives and see if they work here in Scotland too?
Our principal competitors would be the rest of the UK in terms of the research agenda, and we have to make sure that we are at least as good, if not better, and in many respects we are better than other parts of the UK. If we are hitting that benchmark, then it's almost certain we are hitting a benchmark above most of the performance of the rest of the world.
You need to watch them, Paul, though.
Sorry?
I said you need to watch them.
I I guess it's also a question of resource and the focus on that. But I have to say, our universities themselves are actively engaged in looking at what's happening outside. They're involved in many international partnerships as well. And again, I think it's very interesting that we had the vice-chancellors of the six leading research institutions in Hong Kong engage in a dialogue with the Funding Council and some of the principals from Scotland to find out how research pooling in the various disciplines had worked. They're very interested in the success that's emerged from that model. So in terms of where we are in the landscape, I think we're ahead of the game in many respects, and other people are trying to emulate what we're trying to do with the sector here in Scotland.
Okay, thank you. Liam, did you have a question?
Can I firstly offer my apologies to colleagues and to Laurence Howells and his colleagues for being unavoidably absent from the committee. I mean, just on the issue of research, I'd listen with interest to what you were saying, Professor Hagan, in particular, in relation to Mark's questions. I mean, there's undoubtedly been some quite serious concerns raised about recent decisions, particularly in relation to the removal of the Global Excellence Fund, and I think we've had evidence from Dundee University suggesting that this reduces the level of investment in internationally leading research in Scotland. A key partner, the Royal Society, suggests recent changes, quote, might make it more difficult to sustain true global research competitiveness in Scotland, and Edinburgh University go even further, I think, pointing to some of the research they're doing and the world-leading nature of it, but also the extent to which it delivers a considerable saving to the NHS in Scotland. And they say the response to this world-leading impact has incredibly been to cut research excellent grant funding to the university by £40 million per annum by 2017. And they go on, this is in large part the result of the SFC decision to reduce the priority attached to supporting world-leading four-star research and is unlikely to support Scotland's higher education sector to perform competitively at an international level. So I hear what you're saying in terms of our competitiveness with regards to the rest of the UK and indeed internationally. But it would appear that some of those who are delivering that international competitiveness and world-leading research have serious questions about some of the decisions you've taken and the basis on which they have been taken. I wonder if you could help the committee understand the rationale behind those recent decisions.
I'll try to do that. The Global Excellence was provided, and at the time it was provided with a view that it might be a short-term investment. It was provided in advance of the REF2014 exercise, when the reality is there is a transfer market of high-performing staff across the rest of the UK. We were conscious that this activity was underway, and we, and certainly the Scottish Government, didn't wish to see Scottish institutions disadvantaged in advance of REF2014. So additional investment was put into the sector. It was put into the sector by adjusting the weighting for four-star research from 3-1 to 3-star, 3-1 to 4 to 3.11-1. So the increase in weighting for four-star research was simply a mechanism to deliver that additional global excellence funding to the institutions doing the very best research. We operate on the basis of the Board's policy, the Scottish Government's policy, and indeed the sector's view is that all our universities should be involved in research and teaching. The way we distribute the funding to the universities is as a result of their performance in the REF exercise, the research assessment exercise, and in this case, and probably partly as a result of previous investments from the Scottish Funding Council, many of our institutions performed better in the REF 2014 exercise. As a consequence, although Edinburgh improved its performance, many of our other institutions improved their performance as well. So the distribution of four-star research and three-star research across the sector varied. If we'd moved away from supporting research as we had in the current model, then we could have faced the challenge that we were disadvantaging institutions that had improved their performance, and improved their performance partly because we had resourced them to help them improve that performance. Given that it was effectively a zero-sum game, any redistribution as a consequence of the REF was going to hit some of the larger institutions. And we've described this in other places as the peloton had caught up with the leaders of the group. And, of course, you could see that as a bonus for Scotland in that there was a higher quality peer-reviewed research across the whole of the sector, but of course it had the consequence, of course, that, that Edinburgh did see a drop in its funding. Not an, an
It's simply Edinburgh that was expressing that concern. I mean, obviously, Dundee University have also on record.
Well, again, given that they're all in the same pot and it's a zero-sum game, the distribution of funding would change for all of them if all of them increased their performance.
But, I mean, at the very least, I mean, you've set out the rationale for what you've described, I think, as a temporary measure to bridge
yes.
between those REF processes. I mean, presumably, that must have been understood by the institutions themselves at the time. Presumably they may have even been making an appeal to yourselves or to ministers that this period needed to be bridged, in which case it makes it rather surprising that they feel as if the approach that's been taken latterly it cuts against their expectations about what was likely to happen.
I think in terms of global excellence, it was clear from the outset that this might have to be a short-term measure, and indeed in terms of the funding available to us.
Might have to be, or, I mean, in the sense if it was a bridging mechanism, you make clear, governments yeah. use either directly or through their agencies bridging mechanisms the whole time. We've talked this morning at length about a transition period, as I'm sure you found out to your cost turning up on time. But nevertheless, it's made clear that it is a transition mechanism that is time-limited, and it would appear that isn't clear here.
We were clear when we made the funding available, and we were clear that it may not stay there forever.
John.
Thank you, Convener. There's been a number of concerns has been raised about funding and leadership, and University of Scotland, for example, questioned the Scottish Funding Council's ability to introduce further additional places if its budget remains static. It said that this would be a retrograde step at the time when the Widening Access Commission is working to promote a step change in access to university for learners from disadvantaged backgrounds. It also went on to say that it understood that the Scottish Funding Council to be overcommitted in its funding projects, and said institutions are only funded to 96% of the full economic cost of teaching Scottish and EU students. Do you share these concerns, and why?
We introduced the additional places into the system as a long, as a significant long-term measure. If our budget remains static, then we can afford those additional places at the price of managing other budgets that we have, which of course is what we would normally do. Obviously, that is the basis on which we've planned. The issue about the full economic costs is a little bit more complicated. Of course, we have universities who have multiple sources of income, and we expect them to maximise those sources of income, and therefore those contribute to the costs they incur in their provision of teaching. I guess for us, in terms of the priorities that we've got, we would like to continue with the efforts we're making, both to support widening access, which involved us in the kind of things we've described, and at the same time helping support institutions to make a bigger difference to the economy. But it's always going to be a balancing act within the budgets that we've got.
To continue with what you've just explained there, do you consider your current levels of funding to be adequate? To continue with what you've just said there, yeah. do you believe that, or do you consider your current levels of funding to be adequate? This is your opportunity for you to pitch.
There's always more that can be done. I mean, I do think that in Scotland, we have a great set of universities and colleges who are doing a fantastic job for Scotland. I guess for us, the key focus is what more can we do working in partnership with them and with other agencies? And that's the key agenda for us. And it is always important for us all to think about how do we make more efficient the whole system in Scotland, and what do we all do to make it work better together?
More funding would take it.
Obviously, much has been spoken about widening access, and as Dr. Kemp rightly said there, that they're due to provide an interim report. So how much have you put a cost on that as to what it would be to deliver the Scottish Government's ambition, you know, to that access?
I think it's quite hard to cost that because you need to make assumptions about whether you do it by equalising upwards so that the participation rate by, you know, currently the lowest quintile is the same as the highest quintile, or whether the world changes between now and, you know, 17 years' time so that the participation rate maybe equalises but doesn't increase. So it's quite hard to cost that at the moment. There are also costs related to the kind of things you would need to do in order to help schools improve attainment, you know, to put the kind of articulation arrangements in place to support universities in widening access. But those are costs that we have in our budget, and we, you know, it would be how you focus those in future. So I suppose the short answer is I don't know how much it would cost. The Commission is still carrying on its work, depending on the solutions that they propose, and, you know, the ways that access is widened, there could be additional costs, or it's possible there won't. I know that's not a very helpful answer.
No, well, maybe you'll be able to answer my follow-up then. That being said, then, do you believe that perhaps changes are needed in how we allocate our funding to universities, obviously to respond to this increased focus on widening access?
I'm not sure it's so much about how we allocate our funding to universities, but how we use the outcome agreements, which, as I talked about earlier, are a dialogue between us and the universities about how they meet aspirations. And if there is a very clear aspiration coming out of the Commission for widening access, you know, for a series of targets for how we get to the First Minister's aspiration in 17 years' time, then how we use the outcome agreements, which contain within them the widening access agreements, which were set up as part of the 2013 Act, will be very important. So that's more of an issue about how we engage with universities on funding rather than the funding system. But as I say, I don't want to prejudge what the Commission might say on funding. We will hear that maybe in an interim report in November or in the final report in March.
Smith.
To have a bit of clarification on something you said, that if you, in agreement with universities, are asked to provide more university places because of the widening access agenda, did I catch you correctly when you said that some of that funding might come from private sources of income? Could you just clarify exactly what you said there?
No, universities receive funding from all sorts of sources, and they apply that to their business. I wouldn't see an obvious mechanism for increasing places by directly.
So it would all have to come through SFC funding?
The number of places in the universities are effectively regulated, and we fund all of those places at the moment. So that's how we would do that.
Sorry, can I just be absolutely clear about this? If there were additional places that were required to meet the increase in participation from those from more disadvantaged backgrounds, it is your understanding that that would come from public money?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Thank you.
John, did you have any extra questions?
Just very quickly, it was when you're talking here about ambition and aspiration, and it's to refer back to a question that Mary Scanlon had asked about the short-term courses being axed or abandoned in colleges. Do you feel then, or do you believe that perhaps some young kids, people's ambitions, aspirations have been suffered because of that?
The focus on full-time places for young people in colleges, which is something that's been a government priority and colleges have responded well to, has probably enabled more people to meet their aspirations. If you look at, if we were talking about widening access, the higher education in colleges is the area of higher education that has the best record on widening access. The most deprived areas are over represented in that part of education, and that has grown quite substantially in the last few years. Over the last 7 or 8 years, the proportion of school leavers going into higher education, or the number of places in higher education and colleges has doubled. So that, I think, is creating aspiration for a lot of people. And for a lot of people, that aspiration will then go on to university. Against that, some of the courses, the very short courses that are no longer there, were very short courses, were often in the leisure area. We're talking courses of sub 10 hours in some cases. So balancing these two things, I think perhaps some of the part-time courses were things that were valuable, but a lot of them were things that I don't think were as valuable as full-time courses for young people.
Mark, you've got a question, sorry.
Yep. Just a question. You'll be aware of the concerns around the severance packages for senior management at Coatbridge College. And just to ask, part of the funding for those severance packages was provided by the Funding Council. Just to ask why that was provided, given the concerns that I know that the Funding Council had over those payments.
The problem for us is we did think about that. The difficulty for us is had we, let me use a slightly strong term, fined the college for those actions, then that would have simply damaged the service provided to students, since that money couldn't be recovered from those it had been paid to. So on balance, we thought particularly not to burden the existing students and indeed the new college that was being created at that time. We felt it was best for us not to pull that money back.
Okay. So by extension then, since some of the severance packages were funded by the previous Coatbridge College and partly by yourself, then you would acknowledge that since some money has already left the sector, that students in New College Lanarkshire have been disadvantaged by the excessive payouts to the previous management?
We did fund a proportion of the packages at Coatbridge College, but we only funded up to the amount of the Lanarkshire scheme, which was the 13 months, broadly 1 year payback scheme. The proportion above that was paid to some of the senior staff, particularly the principal at Coatbridge College, was not funded by us. However, because that money came out of Coatbridge College's resources, that was not available to New College Lanarkshire afterwards, I accept that.
Okay. Thank you.
A few months ago, I discussed with colleges who said they were short of funding. One had the novel approach of using non-cash depreciation to provide cash. Don't ask me how. It transpired that actually the problem was that ONS had reclassified some of the spend. I mean, what involvement do you have with ONS before they change the classification, which in this case ended up with a very severe potential shortage? Eventually government recovered that. But
we have no involvement with ONS before.
So they can just reclassify,
yes,
education, yeah, and then we end up with a shortage.
ONS reclassified, the government engaged with ONS about that and with, I believe, the Treasury about the implications of that over several years prior to it happening. But we had no direct involvement with ONS about whether it should be reclassified.
But it can have a severe effect on college and university funding.
Not on university funding. Universities haven't been reclassified, but it has had a significant effect on how colleges operate and on how SFC needs to operate, sure, with colleges to monitor spend now that they're part of government accounting. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Liam MacArthur.
Follow up on that. I mean, it was interesting, the discussions, and obviously I would assume that there is a level of discussion at a government level with the ONS about the implications of any reclassification. But presumably, the Funding Council would have had discussions with the Scottish Government about what additional legislative changes the government were proposing would have in terms of their bearing on ONS classification. Is that true?
We didn't have particular discussions about those issues at the time. And my understanding, again, is some of the key issues that ONS were identifying were about, if you like, control and some of the issues about borrowing consents, which are nothing to do with the legislative changes that were taken at the time. It was, to be honest...
Well, there were issues in relation to the control that ministers had in terms of the workings
indeed
of the college sector.
Indeed.
The ONS reclassification happened before the legislative changes that happened in 2013. I suppose, theoretically, the government could have used the opportunity of the 2013 bill to move in the other direction. But the reclassification was prior to that.
Yeah. But that would have been a discussion, presumably the Funding Council would have been involved with ministers.
We discuss all the time, yes, and both in terms of if we're going down this road, how do we mitigate it, and you know, other alternatives.
Okay, thanks.
Mary Scanlon.
I'm just sort of thinking about the overall finances of universities. I got a figure yesterday that the SAAS tuition fee paid to students as a very rough average is 1,820. Now, given that we've got people coming here paying £9,000 in fees, you know, how can we ensure with the controlled numbers we have, I go back to my first question just as an example for GPs, how can we be sure that Scottish universities, you know, choose students domiciled in Scotland, for example, Highlands and Islands, where there's a critical shortage of GPs, etc., radiographers, why would a student choose a Scottish domiciled student who is more likely to go back and work in the Highlands and Islands, as opposed to someone coming from England with a 9,000 fee? How can that be? How can we be sure that's reconciled?
Funding that we give to universities is for Scots and EU students,
That's what I said.
Yeah, no, but the SAS fee is only an element of that. There is our funding on top of that, which, depending on the subject area, brings it broadly in line with the 9,000 that comes from the fee.
The teaching grant's 5,700, so it brings it to 7,600.
It varies with the subject.
Which is still quite a bit less than 9,000.
Yeah, but the institution will not be making a choice between that student that brings in 9,000 or whatever our particular funding is for that level, because they can't substitute between the two. Now, what institutions will do is they will try and recruit students from the rest of the UK over and above our students if they can. But it's now impossible for a student from the rest of the UK to displace a Scottish student, because we have a target with the institution for a number of places for Scots and EU students, and that's what we fund at the institution. And by and large, institutions meet that target. I'm not aware of any recent examples where they've been significantly short. And so it doesn't indicate that, you know, students are being displaced by, you know, theoretically, it could be possible if they only had room for 100 students in a building that they might take the English ones. That isn't happening. In fact, the introduction of the fees for rest of UK students enabled us to withdraw funding from those students who used to be in our system, and it used to be possible for theoretically for a rest of UK student to displace a Scots student. But because that was withdrawn from our system, we used the money we saved to purchase additional places for Scots and EU students. So there are now more places in the system for Scots and EU than there were prior to the introduction of fees.
And is there, when does a target become a cap?
Well, there is a cap as well, which is there to control the SAS costs.
The cap on Scottish students,
yes,
even though there's more places.
Yeah. There is a cap which is over and above our target. So our target is for a particular number of places. Universities can recruit above our number of places and just recruit the SAS, take the SAS fee, but there is a control on that to control the SAS costs. Exists purely to control the SAS costs. However, in cases where institutions want to breach that cap because they want to widen access or meet a particular skills needs, there is now an arrangement in place where they can tell us in advance that we are planning to go hell for leather to recruit more ICT students or more widening access students. And we, through arrangement with the government, will arrange that they can breach the cap if they wish.
Just one final question, which is related to outcome agreements. Just for clarification, could you explain to me whether outcome agreements are concerned with all of the relevant SFC funding, or is it just with specific funding streams? How does that work?
It's for all the key funding streams for any individual institution, but it wouldn't be for example, if we've got a multi-institution project, that would be managed through some different process. But basically, I mean, the absolute vast bulk of provision to whenever universities would be covered in that outcome agreement.
So it's the vast bulk, but that it's just some around the edges, but it's not covered.
For example, if you're managing an innovation centre across multi-institutions, it makes sense to do it in a slightly different way. Okay. We try and integrate them as much as we can.
Thank you very much. Can I thank you for attending? Once again, I apologise for the delay in the start, but I think that helped, Professor Hagan. We're very glad you made it along. Can I thank you all for coming along this morning? We do appreciate your time. And can I close the meeting? Thank you.